cut that shit out? Louis C.K.
has just entered the studio.
What's up, buddy?
Yeah, you cut it out, and then it never looked good. The headliner inside the car would all start falling down.
Oh, of course.
It would come out from the flange because it was never tight enough. It was never watertight.
How'd you cut the hole?
With a sawzall.
You had to have that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You got, you know, you got to have your equipment.
You had to have your tools to put in your own sunroof.
Oh, yeah. A lot of that good shit, though.
Fucking Louis, man. You're, like, really famous now.
Yeah, no. I know. When he walked in.
You're, like, really famous. I'm like, holy shit.
I was looking a little different.
I got a little nervous.
I was like, oh, shit.
We've had Louis on so many times, but now I'm looking at him differently. Like, God, he's really
famous. That's that Louis C.K. guy. I watch his show. And
he does a Leno show, and then that clip goes viral. And holy shit, you're famous.
Crazy.
My
I'm
God.
Not
Funny
famous.
Or Die loves
I'm
you.
I'm not famous.
I'm not.
You're really famous.
Nah, you're pretty fucking famous, there, Louis.
Holy shit, you're famous.
Don't worry, we won't jinx it for you, but yeah.
I'm surprised you're even here. You're that famous. You're not supposed to do the show anymore. You're that famous.
It's so funny how people don't ever see the cycle coming. You know what I mean?
Oh, the up and down?
Yeah. I mean, I see it. I see it already.
Are you
I already
ahead
see
of,
the horizon.
Do you see the coming? Horizon?
Yeah.
Do you see the dip?
Yeah, the not sun rising on the horizon. I already see it.
Louis, I saw you at Carnegie Hall. I didn't want to bother you after the show.
Oh, yeah.
Fucking standing ovation.
And that was pretty fun, man.
But it's just you dressed like shit and a stool getting a standing ovation. I'm like, shouldn't there be an orchestra or something to get a standing ovation?
Yes. No, I'm wearing the same right now. The same clothes I wore.
Yeah, you didn't dress up for Carnegie Hall.
No,
why would you?
I pulled this shit on to be on the radio. I wore the same thing for Carnegie Hall.
I was amazed. I'm like, that's why Louis is as good as he is, because he's not dressed up for
suits,
Carnegie
right?
Hall.
Never.
And the thing is, when I play rooms that size, like the tour I just finished was all rooms that size or bigger.
Jesus.
In Chicago, I did the Chicago Theater. I did two shows there.
Wow.
But,
how big is that?
That's like 3,600 seats. So it was like 7,000 people in one night. And it was the perfect way to get ready for Carnegie Hall, is that by the time I got there, I'm like, well, I've been doing this kind of room. But nothing prepares you for that place, because Chicago Theater, it's enormous, it's beautiful, but it's in the middle of shit Chicago, and the dressing room is peeling paint, and you know, Joey Ramone signed the coffee table, you know, whatever, which I love. That's what I love. But you go to Carnegie Hall, and they show you into the Maestro Suite, which has this gold plaque on it, and
holy
this
shit.
Guy bows as you walk through the fucking door, and it's like, oh my God, this is a whole other. And if Yo-Yo Ma plays there, he doesn't go to the Maestro Suite. He goes to the fucking musician room.
Right, right.
You're the Maestro Suite.
Yeah,
you're the main guy. You're the guy.
George Gershwin fucking got blown in there.
Right.
And so yeah, it's a whole other level.
It was such a great show, and I want to give props to Ted Alexandro. Is he doing all your?
I hired him
for the tour.
No, he did. I toured with him some last year, and this year I worked with Todd Glass a lot and some other guys. But
Ted. I just want to give him props. He's
a funny dude, man.
He didn't know. I hired him the day before
to do Carnegie.
Yeah.
What an asshole.
I know.
What an asshole.
I couldn't
are.
Decide who to open for me, and I figured I can get anybody. But then I got close, and I'm like, no, folks aren't really actually available.
Right.
And I wrote Ted. I love Ted. I just couldn't decide. And then I wrote him the day before and said, I need you at 8 o'clock tomorrow at 57th Street and 6th Avenue. That's all I said to him. And he, smart, he looked it up.
I'm playing the coffee shop?
Yeah. Exactly. Well, he's really, it was funny because he just wrote back, okay. And that was it. Like, he knew what it was. He just went, okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
And you know, he's shitting his pants as writing okay.
But he wore a suit, and his dad came. It was great to have that Ted got there.
Did you feel bad not having a suit? I wear that sometimes, and I'm like, it doesn't feel right, but you just do it because you're like, oh, I think I'm supposed to.
You feel obligated.
Well, I want to wear suits. I wish I could wear a suit. Like, the image in my head of being on stage in a suit and tie. That's really cool.
That's class.
Yeah, that's class.
That's all class.
But then when I wear one, I feel just weird, and my shirt starts coming out of my pants, and I don't
wear a t-shirt under it. Like, I don't wear a tie. I can't wear a tie. It's too fucking restrictive.
Yeah.
Honestly, it works for Lou. It really just,
I
it just
like,
works.
I wish I could dress up. I just don't. I don't. I don't pull it off, and I wish I did.
I think your act and your personality is more conducive to just casual wear.
Yeah, last time I did the Tonight Show, I brought a suit and tie, and I put it on.
It said, fuck this.
And then the last second...
Wow, really?
I was like fucking, what's his name, in Cold Blood, pulling off my, you know, having to pee before I get hung. I ripped everything off and ran out.
Good for you.
Yeah, man. I can't do it. You know, first time I did Letterman, I wore a suit. And I remember Mitch, what's his name, the comedian here.
Hedberg?
Yeah. He came up to me and said, why'd you wear a suit? You don't wear suits. And I was like, well, it's out of respect for the institution. It, to me, doing Letterman was like graduating from something.
Yeah.
And he's like, that's phony. If I did Letterman, I wear sneakers and jeans. And I'm like, well, go ahead. I wanted to wear a suit. He's like, well, it's just, this isn't you. And I'm like, well. And then he did Letterman. He wore a fucking suit.
He did.
Yeah.
What a downer, though. Yeah. It's like, hey, I'm trying to enjoy my
life. I love when people have these phony rebellions. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Exactly. Wow, you and Anne Frank really...
Louis, I got to ask you about the TV show. Where are we at? The first season was a huge hit.
Yeah, it did really great. I mean, you know, only 14 people watch those things. But man, it was well-liked by all 14
everybody.
Of
them. That was one of those.
You did numbers, didn't you?
Yeah, we did well, man. For cable. Yeah, we did great.
FX is perfect place for you.
It's great. I wouldn't want more people to have access to the show, honestly. I really wouldn't.
People start bitching.
Yeah, like we're doing a second season, and we're moving to 10:30 from 11, just inching back a half an hour. At first they said, let's go to 10. That's what they're going to put. 10 is technically kind of primetime television.
Yeah.
So they're going to move it to 10. And because the show, the numbers for the show are strong enough to move it to 10. That's what they told me. To then grow it. And then they said, we're doing 10:30. I'm like, what happened to 10? They said, well, no, we can't. Your show can't. They said, believe me, you're better off.
Well, you don't want them fucking with it. You don't want them moving it to 10 and then going, all right, well, you can't do this. You can't do that.
You have total freedom, dude. I'm exactly where, if I was on any other network at any other time period, I would not be able to do this show the way it is. Because the advertisers wouldn't buy it. He showed the guy at the network showed it to advertisers that buy 10 p.m. time, which is far more expensive than 10:30 time.
Fuck.
And they were like, we're not, what are you, crazy?
You're insane?
When's the second season hit? It's going to be a while.
Guy fucks a hole in a wall and then talks about Jesus.
Puts his penis in the hole.
Yeah, we're not.
That dentist scene that you did was
oh yeah.
Wow.
Thanks.
That fucking that was hysterical. Gervais
the inferred mouth fuck.
Yeah.
I woke up from the dentist once and thought I feel
you
like
thought
he fucked my mouth.
That, right.
Fucked my mouth.
I assumed it was based on something, Lo.
No, that whole thing is true. It is that dentist thing. I took nitrous and lots of drugs, and I went in my mind to the desert.
Wow.
Met Bin Laden and talked him out of terrorism.
I seriously
had that experience so viscerally that when I came out of it and out of the nitrous, I was like, "That's the realest hallucination or dream I've ever had."
That really happened.
Yeah,
damn.
Exactly.
The Ricky Gervais was great on it too.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Fucking, and your reaction to him when he would. Just
stuck his finger in my ass. And, he's great.
And then he would get you again, and you'd get mad at him.
Yes.
It's fucking brilliant.
Well, no, it was a fun
When's the second season going
to
hit? It's a few more months.
June.
Sure.
I start shooting in a couple of weeks.
Great.
I already shot the stand-up for it. I did some stand-up. I did a show in Atlanta, and we shot the stand-up.
Oh, you're changing the venue.
Yeah, I also did the Comedy Cellar.
Right.
But I like I mean, I do more concerts now than I do.
Right.
That I did then, so I just wanted to use the
have. Yeah, right on.
So sometimes you'll see me in a concert, and I'll probably also shoot at Caroline's again. And...
You're really famous,
dude. Louis, something happened where like you were. Louis's a famous guy, but something happened in the last. It was before the show. It started, I think, with almost like the set on Conan.
Yeah.
Talking about flying, something just put you through the fucking roof. Though it was like that next that put you that one level higher where you are just mainstream famous.
It might be the Sarah Palin drunk tweets.
Those actually did a lot. I mean, those did a lot.
Do you feel like
and
you're,
I took them down?
Do you feel like you could still do that, or you're a little worried about what?
It is true that nobody. I mean, the thing that happens with notoriety is that you at first you grow because more and more people like you, But then you get pushed over this edge where people start becoming aware of you that don't know who you are, or and that don't like you.
And take you
That's
out of
the dangerous
context.
Thing about it is that, and because I'd love to have only exactly all the people that are like me,
right,
to know who I am.
That'd be a great world to live in.
And that nobody who doesn't have me as a taste does, is aware of me. And actually, the internet, I think, lets people grow that way. There's people.
Yeah.
I did this tour I did, we sold out every city easily with no advertising, which means you make more money because you don't spend that money. Right. But I was in Philadelphia and I did this show in this huge theater there. I forget what it was called. And this guy I know came and he was like, I don't understand. He's a big money guy. Like, he makes. He invests and makes money. And he says, I live in Philly. I never heard of this show. I never heard your. Coming here.
Wow.
I don't understand how you sold out. And that's because exactly the people that like me know who I am. And nobody else
knows. And they know where you are and where you're going to be. And,
but as I'm pushing a little further, there's people that don't like my shit that know who I am. And that's when shit like saying Sarah Palin has people coming out of her cunt or whatever it was that I said.
It was rather
Chinese
salty,
people
Lou.
Living in her cunt. Yeah, it was a little unnecessary. Yeah,
one of my favorite things
uncalled for.
Yeah,
one of my favorite things is when I get
barbaric attack.
When I get a tweet from someone going, "Oh boy, he's on a plane and he's drunk," and
I go right
to your Twitter and I just follow along. Yeah.
I am definitely like like a stereotypical Indian with the rum. Something happens. happens to me.
Don't you feel
with
compelled?
Rum, Coke and rum, I get riled up.
Yeah,
and I get a little crazy.
You feel compelled to just grab a drink the second you get on a plane.
Yeah, no,
I don't know
it's
what that is with
reason.
Me. I'm like Bloody Mary guy. Like the second I get on a plane, can I have a Bloody Mary? And it's because I never really know or care what time it is. And a Bloody Mary, you could have for breakfast.
No, that's exactly right.
So if it's 7 a.m. and I'm catching a flight or something, it's like, oh, Bloody Mary, and then you just feel good. You're clinking around your little drink and you're drinking and then you start tweeting.
No, because there's something about alcohol and the mixture of oxygen on a plane.
Yeah, yeah.
That's deliberate. It's not the atmosphere. The oxygen you breathe on a plane is mixed by a person. You know what I mean? They decide how much.
Yeah,
how much you need.
If they shut it off, you die. I mean, it's that's how that golfer.
It's helpful,
died.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice to know.
So when you're drinking, the oxygen does.
There's something about the mix that I mean, every plane probably has a mandatory mix. I'm sure there isn't a knob that the person can go, fuck these people, like tweak it up or down.
I think it's factory set.
Let's go to 13%. On these fucking assholes.
They get a little rambunctious. Let's slow them down a bit.
They can feel like they're on Mount
Everest.
Yeah, so airplanes are the only place that most human beings share that there is that your oxygen level is totally regulated.
Yeah.
Because you in this room, I'm sure it's less than outside.
Yeah. This is a great discussion to have with the Secret Service someday if the wrong tweet is sent out. Yes. No, you don't understand. It's the oxygen was regulated.
Yes.
Combined with alcohol.
Exactly.
It was hammered.
I was reading those and I was like, Oh, Lou.
No, I got a lot to lose. It was funny to me the first time I did it. It was funny to me that people got worried for me. Like, I started sending them and I immediately got a response from somebody at FX, a pretty high up executive at FX, wrote and said, "You got to take these down and apologize." I mean, this is within this. All this is
holy
a great, amazing
shit.
Thing about today. I'm on an airplane, and not only am I communicating with the ground, but I am broadcasting to 250,000 people instantly through Twitter, and then getting instant angry feedback from. And receiving it
at 35,000 feet.
All of that is happening at 35,000 feet, and then I'm.
You were talking to way more than 250,000 because
because everyone was retweeting.
Yeah, they're passing along to other people.
It was funny the indignation. I don't know this Louis C.K., but I don't like him. Some of the comments are very funny.
Some people got really angry, and also some.
Oh, you will.
This show fucked me up with it. This show got me in trouble.
Of course, it did.
Because the tweets themselves, people just thought were just childish and pathetic, which they were.
Yeah,
but somebody hooked it up with a YouTube. Sound video of this show where I said stuff about her her kid with Down syndrome.
They'll always rat out. Like, the fans, you gotta realize, people, shut up,
fans.
Be cool.
You raised a brilliant point with that, though.
Chill the fuck out sometime.
Well, you said her age, the kid's age, is not Down syndrome. You won't notice the difference at that age because it's so young. I think that was a brilliant point.
Here's the thing about it. Because I said, the point I was making was that she's saying that there's joys and challenges to having a Down syndrome child. She was saying this during the election.
Yeah.
And at the time, her baby was very, very young, like, you know, less than a month or something.
Right, yeah, it was very young.
And so who cares if it's a Down syndrome baby? Now, of course, I was doing it on this show, and it's not a political show.
No.
So I also said, you know, who cares how many people came out of your retard making cunt? Like, I salted it up a little. I made a little spoonful of sugar is the way I was looking at it.
That was pepper on a substantial meal that you were serving.
Yes.
A little spice.
So, but anyway, all these like Breitbart and some big right wing sites found that video and then hooked it up with the tweets and said he hates. Mm-hmm. People with Down syndrome. That's why. Of course I do. That's why I went after her. Because I just fucking hate those people. But so, and then I felt like I'm okay. I've not said anything. I'm ashamed. But then I got this fucking email from this guy who said, I want to start by saying I hate Sarah Palin. She's a terrible person. But what you said about children with Down syndrome is extremely hurtful. And I'm like, I'm thinking, okay, I didn't say anything bad about people with Down syndrome.
Right.
So I'm nearly deleting the email. And then there's a fucking picture of his daughter. And he says, what you don't understand is that Down syndrome isn't just something that that depletes a person's learning ability. It's a really difficult thing to cope with in life. And a baby with Down syndrome needs surgery often right after birth and medication that you can't believe how expensive it is. He says that her birth was such a difficult thing for our family. It destroyed our family.
Like,
my wife and I broke up over the stress of it.
Wow.
And my daughter's the greatest thing in my life. And we're all, you know, it's just pure joy, but it's so hard. And it's extreme. And he was so respectful that it was breaking my heart.
Yeah.
He never said, you filthy piece of shit. He just said, you're so wrong, you wouldn't believe it.
But it's like,
way off. You're spreading a thing that's really, really harmful. And I felt like such a piece of shit.
But he was making it real, and you're making fun.
Yeah, like, but that guy might have
seen it. I said, though, the one thing I said that was wrong. I don't like saying things that are just wrong. I mean, because it's not wrong that she has a retard-making cunt, because that's what one came out of there. It's not a nice way of saying it.
It's not medical, but
of course not. Your technical jargon.
Yeah. Go ahead, Dr. Lou.
The thing that was wrong to say is that there's no challenges to having a Down syndrome baby. I just didn't know that. And, we always say reckless shit.
Yeah.
I don't care. I don't fact check my comedy.
Sure. No, you shouldn't have to.
The goal is
to
laugh.
Just let it out.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The only thing is, that guy, he might have saved, because what he showed you was the passion that people feel about that. And it's like, they may have come at, like, that may have been a very helpful email in the long run. Like, sometimes you underestimate how frustrated people are with something.
Yeah.
And then you hit it and they come after you and it's fucking relentless.
The best thing would have been like, 5 minutes later, get another email, go, I'm just fucking with you, with a picture of a beautiful daughter, just perfect.
Yeah. She's amazing.
This is my daughter. A's. I'm just fucking with you. I don't care. I was laughing my balls off.
No, and I've gotten angry emails before, and I never care. It's not my lookout. Other people get it. People choose what to get offended by, you know?
Yeah.
People get offended by, I had a funny moment at the Comedy Cellar. I did this joke about 9/11.
Oh, I don't go for that.
You see? I was doing a story about when I was married. It was really about how being married, you're in trouble all the time. You feel like you're in trouble when you're married, Anthony. Yeah,
constantly.
I don't get that sense from you. You guys seem like you're okay.
Yeah, we're all right, man.
Yeah.
I wish
you
had a story.
That's because you hit her, right? Because if you hit her, it's
constantly got her.
So it goes the other way.
What's better than when you go to scratch your eye and they flinch?
But honestly, my old relationship, I can relate. Yeah.
You
walked around feeling like you were in trouble. So, you're hitting on something.
So I was in L.A. and at 6 in the morning, my hotel room phone rang. And my wife at the time was crying. And I was like, what the fuck is this? Did she find a phone sex bill? She can't talk. I'm like, what is it? And then she tells me, turn on the TV, and it's both the World Trade Center towers are on fire. And I was like, woo!
That's the only person
to be deeply relieved
that it wasn't something else.
That two planes were flown.
That
America would never feel safe again.
That's a great show.
Anyway, I did it. I told that story at the Comedy Cellar, and this guy stood up and just stood up in that little room and said, "That's not okay, man. It's not okay." And he walked out. So then I'm upstairs talking to Mark Maron, a comedian,
and I said,
this guy told him the story, and I said, you know, I hate people that pick the thing in the show. That's what I'm offended by, because I said all kinds of shit in that show, and he let it go, but that's his sensitivity. So I said, it's really narcissistic of people to decide what they're going to be offended by. And Mark said, that's how insane it is that you're saying, calling that guy a narcissist, when your whole, that joke is the most narcissist thing I've ever heard in my entire life.
It's only important to
that
you.
You were pleased that thousands of people were dead because you weren't in trouble with your fucking wife, because you didn't know how to fucking face your wife.
Shit.
That's really funny.
Once in a while, you get fucking shit. Like, I did a 9/11 joke. It was probably a year after, not even, and I was doing something, and it wasn't a knock on 9/11. It was like somebody misinterpreting it, but the woman in the audience...
It wasn't a knock on 9/11?
Yeah.
I didn't mean to insult 9/11. Hey. It was a brilliant program. I mean, it's one of the most successful things I've ever seen.
But it was one of those things where... I knew the person was misinterpreting the point of the joke, and she was kind of like saying something, and the woman behind her was looking at me, and she was just shaking her head no, like don't do
this.
I started going after her, and the woman behind her was like, and I backed off, and then they told me after, like, her husband died, and so I was really happy I backed off, because I was going to make it a whole big, like, thing like that, like, you fucking cunt, what the fuck, right. Don't mind me talking about rape.
Right.
But once in a while, you back off, and you're happy you did. It's like, even though technically, all right, she was being annoying.
Yeah. Well, you're talking to a group of people, and you could never be aware, you can't make, you know, make people fill out a thing and then do a data report.
Right.
Well, that's why anybody that calls or however they get in touch with us and they say something like, you know, I'm a big fan of the show. I've been listening to for years.
But that one
when
thing.
When you said this, and it's like, you listened for years. You know how many fucking people we probably upset over the years that weren't you? You fucking idiot.
No, exactly.
Yeah.
But, and a lot, also, some people get offended just because they, I'm sure there's 9/11 victims who find that shit funny. There has to be.
That has
because
to be, right.
The, like, a lot of times when we make fun of these things, we're just using them as a in a context.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the thing I said is about the misery. Marriage is so prohibitively constraining that a national disaster is good news.
It's not so
to
much
you,
making light of the disaster. Problem. It's showing how awful marriage is.
It's also brutally honest.
Yeah.
A lot of people have felt relief at something that wasn't affecting them that was worse for other people. You were just being fucking ugly and naked and honest about it. That's the beauty of it.
This is the most fucked up thing to say, but if you suffered
you could have stopped
direct,
the attacks and didn't.
I could have, but I wanted the bit. I had inside information. But I thought, God, that bit is so funny, I'm going to let it go. If you suffer directly or indirectly from something, you don't own it. You just don't.
No, you don't. You're right.
Unless your name is 9/11.
We have, all of us in here, have goofed on things that have directly affected our lives.
Sure.
Personally affected our lives.
Of course.
And some of the things people know about, some they don't.
Yeah, but you
whatever.
Know, it's not
and
yours.
You just do it. It's not yours. It's not fucking... It's whatever it is. You put it over the air to make people laugh or think or whatever the fuck we're doing in here. But it's not... You know, I'm not singling out all the people that this will offend. Hey, let me offend some people today with this. No, I'm going for the people that it doesn't
offend.
No, and again,
if you took part in something or something, you suffered from something, that doesn't give you the right to, if it's a thing that happened in the war, especially something that happened to the whole country, you don't get to control who gets to say what about
it.
And by the way, you get to get offended about it. That's my main thing about people getting offended. Yeah, you got offended. So that gets to happen.
There's been
that's part of living on the earth.
But there's been this whole thing that's taken place over the past few years where people absolutely believe that there is a right
to not be offended.
To not
hear something.
And especially if it's over airwaves and stuff like that, they think that the FCC, they can complain to the FCC and say they were offended by something and absolutely think that the FCC will go, hey, fuck you.
Well, you know, I subscribe to the thought that laughter really is the best medicine.
It's straight talking, Jim.
Yeah, you know. Right.
I got an email once because of the Catholic Church video that I have on YouTube where I go to the church and find out that they completely exist to fuck boys in the ass.
Hilarious, fucking hysterical.
And I've gotten the number emails about that, and less than I thought I would.
Wow.
But it's funny that most people that complain about it, they'll say, Jesus is Lord and you've offended him, and I'm going to crack your fucking head open, you motherfucker.
Yeah.
Like, I get that all the time.
Which is really an odd
little... People say, from a Christian point of view, you've hurt Jesus, and I'm going to fucking split your head open, you cunt. Like, they're so profane and so threatening.
That forgiveness shit goes out the window. When it comes to religion.
But anyway, one guy wrote to me and said, my uncle is a Catholic priest and you insulted him. And I wrote him back and I said, no, I did. I don't know your uncle. I didn't insult him. No,
personally.
I made a broad joke about a whole group and it's got nothing to do with your uncle. And he wrote back and said, I know, but, and then we wrote back and forth and we figured it out.
Are you two fagged out? What happened? I don't like the end of that story.
I gotta interrupt because we got Ron Perlman outside the studio.
He's out at 8:15.
He only has a few minutes, so we should get him in as well.
Yeah,
by the way, as Ron makes his way into the studio, Louis C.K., hilarious, will make its network television premiere this Sunday night at 10 on Comedy Central.
Yes.
Hearing great things about Hilarious.
I've seen it.
What's up, Ron?
It is hilarious.
And it's going to be on CD and DVD Tuesday, January 11th.
Perlman.
Louis C.K. But first, we got Ron
Perlman
in the studio.
Hey, how you doing? Worry, nice to meet you. Thank you,
Ron Perlman, huge fan of Louis C.K.
We're on the same network. This guy,
the FX.
I know, unbelievable with the Sons of Anarchy.
That show was so good.
I don't fucking know.
Same place.
Sons of Anarchy.
They're very liberal-minded, those guys.
Yes,
and stupid.
That's crazy.
What's up, Ron?
How you doing, everybody?
Yeah, man. Been
Welcome
watching
to the
Ron
show.
For years.
Good to see
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely.
Unbelievable. One of my favorites, I got to just bring it up real quick, Alien. What was it? Resurrection.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was good.
That was one of the franchises I managed to close down. I went through a spate of that. I closed down a lot of venerable old institutions. Star Trek, they never made another one of those.
That was done. They had to reboot the whole
thing. What I'm proud of, and this is probably more public service than anything else, was I closed down the Police Academy franchise.
Oh, thank you for doing that.
Wow,
you're
really on the last one of those?
Yeah. You should get a trophy for that.
Definitely the last one of those. And I take personal credit for it too.
But look at what you're doing with like Hellboy. People love Hellboy.
I closed that one too.
You closed that one. I liked it. Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
You're in the island of Dr. Moreau. How nuts was Brando to be around?
Brando was actually he was like the Rock compared to some of the shit that was on that set.
That's one of the weirdest movies I ever saw.
That was like, you know, after Heaven's Gate, the biggest clusterfuck in movie history.
Really?
Yeah.
Did him and Val Kilmer not like each other? There was something between him and Val Kilmer?
I really can't comment. One of them is still alive.
Yeah, that movie was crazy.
Yeah.
That movie just started feeling like you were just hanging around that island after a while.
You actually like felt like you were there?
You should have been there. It was. I mean, they actually hired me. I was really in essentially one scene and then a couple of little pops, you know. And I was, my deal was for 3 weeks. I ended up being there for 4.5 months.
Oh, my God.
And, at one point I just turned to the director and said, what the fuck is going on? And he goes, well, and it was the great John Frankenheimer, one of his last assignments, the great late John Frankenheimer. But he was like an old school dude, just completely like not part of the 21st century at all. And, although this was the early 90s, so he was entitled, I guess. He says, well, Marlon says, give it to the guy from Quest for Fire. I said, give what to the guy? She says, every one of Val's lines. Just give it to him.
The guy from Quest.
That guy can act. So I said, so I'm, you know, I may be here for the rest of my born days, right? He goes, possibly, Ron.
Oh my God.
You're in Season of the Witch.
That's true.
Is the new movie that's coming out.
Mm-hmm.
Nicolas Cage.
Right.
Nicolas Cage. What a movie machine he is. Jesus Christ.
He makes a lot of films.
He does make a lot of goddamn films.
He's got to be pulling in $300,000-$400,000 a year.
He's put an edge.
He seems...
Do you think that much? I think he's working on 3 right now.
Jesus.
Like simultaneously. The fuck?
He's going to start doing them live after a while.
No, that's me. I'll come to your house if you can't go. I'll do the whole fucker. I play all the parts.
When is that opening up?
It opens Friday.
Friday?
Friday the 7th, yeah.
And who are you in that?
I'm his buddy.
Oh, really? Is this a stretch?
It's a buddy film. It's a lot of things. But essentially, what was most attractive to me was that, you know, he and I are these two warrior knights in the Crusades, and we've been fighting kind of shoulder to shoulder for like a dozen and a half years, and it's on that level. It's a buddy movie, and then it's kind of like Bing Crosby and Bob Hope road picture.
On the road.
We are all things to all people. And then there's a little witchcraft, a little this, a little that, you know, a little song and dance.
When you got into acting, did you think, because you have become kind of this action star guy.
Yes, at 60 I turned.
More than 60.
When I can't do anything about it, they actually want me to run up hills.
Oh, Jesus.
Wow. Yeah, because I've noticed over the years, like at first, early on, you weren't really cast in the action roles, and now, you know, a little later in your career, I guess.
Well, everyone else has died off. Is what's happened.
That's what it is. So they're giving you the parts.
Yeah, if you hang out long enough, you're the only one that's left on that list. You know.
And you were on. You were like one of the most well-known, unrecognized people on Beauty and the Beast years ago.
Yeah.
When you're on that TV series, how was that? That must have been. Was it frustrating for you?
No, actually, just the opposite. You know, yeah. I mean, I, you know, you see guys like Nick Cage. Really have to give thought to their every movement, you know. They just, you know, and I'm at the, you know, the Gelson's in LA at, you know, like, you know, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and no one cares.
No,
I mean, you know, I can go anywhere. I can just to this day, and do anything. I have never had to make an alteration to my, you know, sordid lifestyle.
You're pretty recognizable, though. Jesus.
Well, yeah, I think the FX show, you know, this, which is the same that Louis on. Magnified the profile, but you know, I mean, I was able to basically move through life, you know, unfettered, because just nobody gave a shit.
Fucking honesty, I love it.
Holy shit!
Hey, it's a little too early in the morning. It's, to lie.
You know what? More of that. Let's say hi to Bill in Boston, Bill.
Bill.
Hey, Ron, I just want to let you know that I love your work on Sons of Anarchy, and I really like the Mutant Chronicles. I really enjoyed that movie. Thanks for all your work.
Oh, it's my pleasure, my friend. My pleasure.
All right. You have a question, or you just want to kiss his ass? I guess that's it.
No question.
All right, no question.
Have a nice day, Bill.
I just love Sons of Anarchy and everything.
And the Mutant Chronicles.
And of course, yeah.
Yeah.
Who will ever forget?
What do you? I guess a lot of people.
Bill didn't forget.
What do you like watching? What kind of shows you enjoy?
I've turned into a political junkie a little bit.
Really?
But I get all my news through MSNBC because I'm like, you know, I'm a lifelong, you know, lower middle class Jew lefty from upper Manhattan, you know. So, you know, I like having my news filtered through, you know, a blue lens.
Through the liberal.
I'm a Chris Matthews freak. Watch that show, TiVo that show every day. And, you know, when I'm on my own time, it's just Turner Classic Movies, pretty much.
Yeah.
That's my antidote to a cold, hard, really cruel world.
Really?
Do you go back and watch old black and white movies and go,
what a time.
Oh, Humphrey. Carrie. Bert. You know,
that's it, man. I mean, you know, it's just another time and place.
Simpler time, yes.
It seems like it was. There was a little order of the universe back then.
Little English people with high collars arguing very politely.
Yeah, with their little pinky out.
I was watching one of those movies, and it was these English guy in trial for murder, and the lawyer is supposed to be a brilliant, arguer or whatever, debater. You're better than me. Yeah. And he's like, "I put it to you that you murdered her," and the guy says, "I put it to you that I didn't." I put it to you that you did. And everyone's like, ooh.
A lot of people are putting it to a lot of other motherfuckers. Yeah, yeah.
Got some people booing that you said MSNBC. They're right.
Oh, really?
Ah, fuck them.
Well, politics will absolutely divide everybody and get them.
Yeah, but it's like a sports team now.
Right.
Yeah, Fox, it really is. News versus MSNBC.
Yeah, that's all it is. You're right.
Fuck the Red Sox. You know.
Yankees, Red Sox.
Start buying your MSNBC jersey now.
Yeah, because ask that guy, why don't you like it? Well, because just liberal. What is it about liberals you don't like? Just because... Is bashing Bush. No, he's not even president anymore. Yeah, but liberal. It's just the same. And it's the same on the other side. Why don't you like Fox News? Just because it's just conservative.
All of a sudden, you just went gay when he talked about
it. No, it's California. It's not gay.
Yeah,
it's California. It's just conservative.
I slip into that all the time myself.
No, I do too.
Are you involved politically at all in any?
Just in my living room.
Your armchair kind of?
I yell and scream. I mean, I'm very, very politically involved in my car.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So you could yell and scream. Do you check in on what the other side's talking about and doing?
Absolutely
get yourself annoyed?
Not. Absolutely not.
No?
Really?
No. I just don't. I don't give a fuck. It's all poppycock to me.
What do you think? Does it affect you in any way? Do you really think it affects you in any way personally? Who's in charge? Like now, today, as a matter of fact, you know, the Republican House is going to be sworn in. Do you think that is going to affect you in any way, shape, or form?
Yeah, they're not swearing in anybody else because just
the Republican House.
I actually do. I really do. I really do think that that government plays a role in people's everyday lives. You look at things that are historic landmark sweeping legislative victories, you know, like the Civil Rights Act and Medicare and Medicaid and all that stuff. And even the abolishment of slavery, which were things that really affected the whole sort of not just spiritual,
it affected the South,
but
a little bit.
It always came with these horrific, bloody fights, and there are still people today that are railing against FDR,
for
socialist
welfare state,
sorry to interrupt you, but slavery emancipation, was that a piece of legislation or was it an executive
to be an amendment to the Constitution.
It was an amendment to the Constitution
because the original Constitution allowed for slavery the Civil War was the execution of the unearthing of the illegality to secede from the Union, number one, and number two, then they needed to add an amendment to correct
when you put an amendment, Congress has to do that, right?
Or Congress has to do that.
The voter has to be a huge lopsided vote or something.
Some guy just sneaks into the middle of the night and writes it and goes, "No, that was here."
That was here.
You didn't see this?
In fact, John Boehner was in office back then.
Good old Boehner.
Politics are very polarizing. How many times have I said that, Lou? Hundreds.
It really is, though. But I know some actors really get on board. You know, like Sean Penn is going down there and meeting with
Chavez.
Chavez, and yeah, he's always going over the Middle East, and
he's consistent. I don't agree with him, but I'll say this. He's a very consistent guy.
He is consistent.
And he's a fucking amazing actor. So it's like I love his work. I he's a guy who I find annoying, but I love him so much. His work is so good. It's like you can't not like the guy.
Yeah, because some guys, some actors that are into politics, it seems like they're just trying to find more lists that they can get on.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not really about right. the cause. It's like, that's I got I like. To go. Like, when I hear that the White House briefed Barbara Streisand, yeah. I'm like, don't fucking waste all what these people's time.
You're doing that. That's why I like.
She just wants to know that she can fly jet into D.C.
That's why I like Ron just does get it from his living room.
Right. I don't know. I do. I, you know, I think that there are people who spend their lives, you know, professionally doing that, and I have a different life choice professionally, and it's not, you know, I also think that it's not necessarily helpful when entertainers get involved in things that they yeah. shouldn't. You know, yeah. you see some of these, like, guys that appear before Congress to testify about, you know, their pet peeve. And
yes.
I
mean,
that kind of rubs me the wrong way.
Yeah. You know? I don't think that helps.
Yeah. When they have I don't think it's helpful. I think the best thing I can do for somebody I support is stay as far the fuck away from them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because, you know, what happens if you know, they don't like, you know, a movie I did?
Yeah.
That guy's going to lose votes.
It's an awful way for a cause to get shot
yeah.
down.
Yeah, exactly.
Because yeah. Police Academy 8 stunk yeah. so bad.
Yeah, fuck the unborn. That movie stunk.
That's right. You know, so I just quietly... You know,
well, I mean, there's a reason I have a Lead by Example bumper sticker on. I mean, that's the way I feel.
Jimmy's disgusting me today. Are you getting a lot of bikers getting in touch with you and stuff? Are there some frightening people that you've met because of Sons of Anarchy?
Oh my God, yes.
Yeah.
yeah, they're frightening, but they're showing us a huge amount of love.
Yeah, I don't doubt it.
Are there any that don't like you? Or are there any that feel like that's not the way we are, man?
No one has emerged yeah. so far that doesn't like. I'm sure there are people sticking, you know, pins and dolls, you know, Ron Perlman dolls. Hellboy dolls. You know, no, I've actually, you know, we only work 5 months a year, which is the beauty of working on FX. You only do 13 episodes, so you have a lot of time to do other stuff. And between the second and third season, I was like all over the United States doing various other projects. And every time it became known that I showed up in like Albuquerque or you know, Illinois, something like that, I would get a message, you know, the guys want to sit down,
oh,
you know, and have a little sit down.
Oh, shit.
And I go, yeah, I'm, you know, I'll, let me give you a call.
Yeah.
So I've yet to take advantage of it, but
flight out of it.
You know, that's when, you know, you realize how insignificant what the New York Times has to say about your work is.
Yeah.
Well, yeah,
know,
yeah.
But, you know, when the bikers actually endorse you and say, you know, you know, we're not that thrilled that there's, you know, because, you know, they're outlaws essentially at the end of the day, and mm-hmm. they'd rather stay off the grid and off the radar. But they have shown us a huge amount of support for how nuanced the show is, how ungratuitous the show tries to stay, and how, you know,
that you don't stereotype it and just paint a typical
yeah,
picture.
Yeah, well, you know, because pretty much every time you've seen anything with bikers, except for like Easy Rider, which was like not really a biker thing. It was just two guys on bikes, but it's usually pretty superficial. It's usually just like, you know, they use the world, you know, for ends that don't really service the world or that stereotype the world.
Right into a town.
Yeah,
rape,
do you remember
pillage,
Joe
leave.
Namath made a biker movie?
Oh, damn.
C.C. Rider.
C.C. Rider.
No. He made the biker movie.
Yeah. And they show him walking through a supermarket and like grabbing a milk carton and drinking it and then throwing it on the floor and just
crazy.
Like pushing people around a little bit.
Oh, he was crazy in that.
Crazy biker guy.
Oh, God.
Joe Namath. This show is so good, though. Have you watched it?
Sons of
yeah.
It's so good. And I don't keep up with anything regularly. I just don't have time, and I've got kids and stuff. But
very busy, man.
Every time it comes on, every time I see it, I think I can't, because dramas, a lot of dramas are too intense and too involved. and you'll see guys talking, and the scene's like this low talking. Cyrus wants to meet on Tuesday, but do we have the chips to, you know, leverage that's him? And I'm like, what the fuck are you people talking about? But if when I watch that show, I watch for 2 more minutes, and then I'm like, wow, they got to get Cyrus to meet. What's going to happen to him?
I hope Cyrus doesn't decide to be a no-show.
Yeah.
Do you ride? Do you?
I don't ride well. I'm not that guy. You know, it's funny because there's the whole rest of the cast that just loves the bikes,
mm-hmm.
and then there's me. That's just
not big
an
on
actor
the,
playing a part.
Yeah,
but you have to ride.
You have
certain
to ride.
Scenes.
You
yeah,
have
so
to ride.
Are you like, but, let me go straight, and then could you get someone in here to make the turn for me?
Well, they hired me to do this part while I was doing a movie in Romania. So I literally for the pilot. And which segued right into the first season of filming, I got off a plane on Sunday night and on a Harley Monday morning. Oh, had never Jesus. Been on a bike before in my life. Holy so shit.
And those are heavy yeah. bikes to
yeah.
start on.
Yeah, my bike is just shy of 1,000 pounds. So.
Did
yeah.
you regret we riding motorcycles under special skills on your resume?
Yeah, I did. That and horseback riding. I pretty much lied about whatever you can think of.
Juggling, French.
The only thing I really never lied about was the knitting.
That's hard to fit that into the show.
I've
though.
Never done a movie about knitting. No, yeah, I just took so much time out of my youth to learn how to purl and whatever. Anyway, so the first season, you know, you'd see me pulling out in a really dramatic fashion, and then you'd see me pulling in. And the rest of it was, you know, the back of some stunt guy's head. In the hiatus for the second season, I actually spent some time on a bike, you know, tried to find a little bit of a comfort zone, which I'm still terrified of.
Yeah, I'm
that particular fan of you know.
The bike. It's scary.
Yeah. I'm terrified.
I like a little metal around me when I'm driving on the road.
This machine pulling you by the arms. You.
I mean, I don't even like going
nasty. Pulling you by the arms.
Yeah, that's what it feels like. I used to have one, and I rode a motorcycle for like 2 years in New York City. That's and I was tough. Never totally unscared. I was always a little. I wanted really badly to get in an accident that wouldn't hurt me. Like that was my fantasy, and it's exactly what happened to me. I cracked the bike up really badly, and I was fine.
You can't.
So I could say, "Oh, I don't."
I'm done. You just can't be on alert that long.
No,
every day.
Can't scratch
you
your
can't
nose.
Can't have like this. No. You know, sometimes when you're driving your car, you could just kind of drift off a little as long as your peripherals are working. On a bike, it's just like constant fucking on a state of alert.
I was in a helicopter once going to doing a show in Western Pennsylvania, and the guy, he's just holding up the joystick with both hands, and he says, I'm just chatting with him about how it works, and he goes, well, if I have a muscle twitch and let go, we just drop out of the sky.
Oh, great. Thanks for letting me know that.
Yeah. Oh, you should have said to him, hey, thanks for sharing.
Yeah.
That's what I should have said. That would have been
many years ago, I was going to do a film about, you know, like these Long Island bikers. And so I needed to learn how to ride. And I was still living here in New York at the time. So I took this like safety course, which you're required to take first to learn how to ride the bike. But then you got to spend all this classroom time because you got to take the written test because you got to get the license, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we walk into the classroom experience. And, you know, the first thing the instructor says is, who here can say what the percentage of people who ride a bike get into a crash? So one guy says 20%. He says a little higher. And this goes on and on and on. Finally, he says, nobody? Nobody? 100%.
Really?
And he wasn't jiving, man. I mean, if you ride a bike, you are going to crash.
At some point in your bike
you
riding
are gonna
career,
crash.
You'll crash.
And you could be phenomenal at it. But but other drivers are not looking for bikes. Mm-hmm. You know, people are like changing lanes like crazy.
The classic is the left turn in front of people. People will just... I drive a fucking Escalade. And people turn left in front of me. Like, what are you doing?
They can't see you.
This thing is battling.
No, and on a motorcycle, you're only on two wheels. So if you have a slight hitch in the flow of your driving, you fall down. And in a car, if you have like, oh, whoops. Then you just sort of.
But there's nothing more challenging than riding a Harley and trying to text message back to your manager.
Have you tried doing
I'm running late, you know.
I had a moped accident when I was 15. I did.
Wow, the, really fitting in, Jim.
I don't want anybody to be alarmed, but I mean, I had one when I was 15. And I flipped off the top, and I said, I'll never be on a motorcycle. It just scared me.
You never were on a motorcycle.
I was on a moped. That's what I'm saying. I would never do it after that. It scares me.
Are you okay?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I'm fine. Sometimes I still wake up screaming.
Was the motor running, or were you in pedal mode?
Literal fucking asshole. I almost answered you. No, the motor was running. All kidding aside, I shouldn't joke about this. I really am a jizz bag.
Motorized vehicle that you call some pedal.
We got Ron Perlman in studio. We got to let him go in a few minutes, but John in Jersey has a great question. John.
Hey, Ron, just want to say love the Sons of Anarchy and all your work and some of the other movies. My question is, honestly, how big are Katie Seagal's cans? Are they really as big as they look?
It's a great question.
You know, I never looked.
I never looked.
It's just about the eyes.
Of course.
It's all about, you know, eye to eye.
What do you think, John?
Yeah, what do you think, John?
Extremely large. I'm just wondering if I, you know, if I could get a size or something like that.
He needs it for a spectacle.
Probably best for you to go to katiesegal.com.
Yeah.
And I think there's a little column on the left which says measurements. You have to log in. I don't know. I really don't know.
Hey, Ron, have you ever
trying to save my job here.
It's a funny thing. It's such a dumb thing to ask.
It really
about
is
something that you know. That girl looks like she's got big tits. I got a question now. Does she have big tits? Does she,
I know.
I mean, I see her and her tits are really big, so are they big? I just want to know if her tits are big.
We don't, I will say this, John. There's no CGI on the show.
Okay.
It's all,
so deal with that.
Digital video.
We got to get Ron out of here because he's doing TV. Where are you going next, Ron?
He's all over the place.
WPIX.
Oh, look at you.
Oh.
The original home of the New York Yankees.
That's right. Yes.
When the scooter used to do the games before leaving in the third
Holy
inning.
Holy cow.
You New Yorkers.
Yeah, you know, I talk scooter. Whoever was going
to
listen.
Scooter would leave, though.
Say hi to Jill Nicolini over there for me.
Thank you. I sure will. Yes. But, I mean, I go back to when Red Barber was doing Yankees.
I don't remember
games.
Red Barber.
Red Barber here.
Yeah. It was Frank Messer, Bill White, and the scooter.
Yeah, no, well, that's like,
70.
For me, like third generation. It was originally, the scooter was just segueing into being an announcer. He had just stopped being the shortstop.
Oh,
when I started watching the game.
Jesus.
Wow.
Pre-money store.
Yeah, in fact, they hadn't invented cleats yet when I started watching Yankee games. That's not true.
No,
but anyway,
isn't that distressing that we all went really?
Yeah,
really.
It was Mel Allen, they'll never be the better voice of the Yankees.
Mel Allen.
This Week in Baseball is where I know him from. I didn't know him as a Yankee announcer.
Yeah, he was the Yankee announcer through my because I started watching games during the real heyday of the franchise, which was in the 50s, which is the entire career of Mantle. Most of Yogi Berra, you know, Whitey Ford.
How fucking old are you? You're not that old.
You're in really good shape.
Yeah.
For what you remember.
Yeah.
Those memories usually fit inside of a really disgusting bag of shit.
Oh, I know. Huh?
Yeah. What a bunch of queers we are. Really? Yeah. You saw Scooter play? You have a great body for that.
No, I mean, my dad walked me into a Yankee game, my first game, on like 1952. So I don't mean
Jesus.
I think that's why you got your action films later in life, because now that you've gone gray and your whiskers look hard beaten, it's more interesting to see you, like, you know, chomping a cigar and fucking with somebody, like looking, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
you want to see a guy that looks like this. It's got the copper in his blood has started showing in his hair a little bit.
It's like,
you know,
he's got
more interesting.
He's got the look where he has the experience of fucking people up for a lot of years.
Yeah, exactly. That's somebody you want to watch a guy punch in the face.
That's a compliment.
I don't want to watch fucking, never... you know, whenever Leonardo DiCaprio balls up his little fucking boy fists and punches somebody,
yeah.
You see the guy who, like, reel back, like,
oh!
And you're like, nah, he didn't hit you that hard.
Yeah.
I want to see Ron Perlman fucks. You know, he's one of those guys who you could actually believe that he could just turn your head and kill you. That thing.
That
snap. Yeah.
I want to see a fist that's been holding cock since the 50s punch somebody.
That actually didn't start till 61. All right, but
after Mantle had already.
Once Mantle was gone, it was just me and my cock.
Oh fuck! We got to get Ron out of here, unfortunately.
Yeah. Wow.
Season of the Witch. It's in theaters this Friday
with Nick Cage.
Yeah.
And FX, Sons of Anarchy.
Great show.
It's a great show. Absolutely. And of course, all our other wonderful Ron Perlman gems that we love so much.
Thank you so much.
He ruined the franchise, but I love that goddamn Alien Resurrection.
Yep.
And I think, you know, at that point, the franchise was done anyway. I don't think you had anything to do with it. You played a badass in that. I like that. Yeah, that was a good one.
Thank you, man. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure,
Ron.
Being here, guys.
All right, Ron Perlman, everyone.
All right.
Fucking laughing our balls off. A little taste of Louis C.K. doing Hilarious, which is going to be on TV Sunday night at 10 p.m. on Comedy Central. And then on Tuesday, you can get the CD and or DVD, Hilarious. And we got Louis C.K. in studio today. Fucking laughing hard at that shit.
Thank you.
So fucking funny, man.
Thank you.
Damn it.
Well, that was two specials ago now.
Yeah.
All right, stop bragging.
Well, I mean that it's old.
It's old in his mind, but that shit is as current as anything.
We took this as a movie. This is the one we took to Sundance as a movie.
Oh, really?
It was the first stand-up performance film that showed at Sundance.
Wow.
And did really well there. It was fun.
That saloon shit is just great.
The vagary of the old west.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Goddamn, Louis. I hate funny people.
How's the personal life? How's the daughters? Everything
They're
good there?
They're great. My kids are great.
Yeah.
My daughter's, the oldest one is in third grade and the other one's in kindergarten. They go to the same school now, which is a massive savings of time.
Oh,
with
walking them to different schools. Yeah.
Pick them up at two different schools.
Are you going to reflect
now? It's a one-stop drop.
Are you going to reflect that in your TV show, or like how accurate is the daughter
TV show very different?
Show or like are they going to grow up on the show? Or are you going to have to replace them? Are you going to age them rapidly like a soap opera?
Well, the girls on my show are totally different than the girls my kids.
Yeah,
they only represented in age. But my kids are nothing like those girls. They're really fictional. I mean, most of my family.
I never thought that they were an accurate depiction of your kids, even though I don't know your kids. But is the way you're reacting to them, that seems to be like you.
No, that is definitely different too.
That's
my daughters
too?
And I have.
Do you beat your children? Is that what you're not showing on the show?
My daughters and I have a very real and close relationship, a very warm relationship, and we're just great friends. They're my favorite people, my daughters, and we get along great. And I used to get frustrated when I was younger. At having kids, just getting through a day with kids used to be a chore.
From your act, we would never have known.
Yeah,
that.
Exactly. Well, and I definitely distilled and purified that frustration for the sake of entertainment. I've had all through being a dad incredible moments and times in my life that are completely unfunny. So those are kept out of there.
Yeah,
no one wants to see that. No one ever will.
No way to make it funny.
No way. Like I did a bit during this last tour I did about sleeping and my daughter's waking me up in the morning, like at 6 o'clock every morning. And I don't need to get up to like 7:30 to get them to school, but they get me up at 6. Because they're awake and they want to share the day with me, you know?
Yeah.
So I did this bit about how good sleep feels at 6 a.m. Like how much I don't want to wake up because I feel like I'm, you know, fathoms deep in a river of chocolate and sleep is like an ancient whore who's sucking me off slowly and speaking in a dead language, you know, this whole thing I do about how much I don't want to wake up, and then I wake up and I'm miserable. When I conceived that bit, the second part to it was the truth, which is as much as I hate getting upright at 6 a.m., once I'm feeding my kids breakfast and we're chatting, I'm so happy to get up.
Yeah.
Because when I'm on the road or when my kids aren't with me,
I always sleep till like noon or 1 o'clock, and I wake up, I feel like a piece of shit, and most of the day is gone. But I get up at 6 o'clock, and even though the transition is difficult, standing there and feeding them, I feed them a full breakfast every morning. I make them bacon and eggs and stuff, and I stand there watching them eat it, and we chat, and it's such a great, it's such a real life to me. That's real. When I started it on stage, I'd tell the part about sleeping and about not wanting to wake up, and then I'd get to that part, and the laughter would just completely stop.
Oh, shit,
I had no way to make
it's
that funny.
Funny.
So I stopped doing it.
Oh, you're a good dad. Go fuck yourself.
Yeah, exactly. So I just dropped that part off.
Where does the Louis from the TV show?
Well, that guy, I mean, I like on the show to be just to make mistakes I never would, and to be more reactive and have less control over myself. It's just funnier.
It's you're in a weird situation with this, and I think it's a good person to compare it to. Seinfeld, I think, went through the same thing. A lot of people assume that's Seinfeld because he's Jerry Seinfeld on the show.
Mm-hmm.
That's Jerry Seinfeld.
Yeah.
And that is not Jerry Seinfeld.
Yeah, no, he's not
on the show.
No.
So when you watch your show, you're Louis, you're a stand-up, you're doing what you do.
Yeah.
So a lot of people assume that's an accurate depiction of you head to toe. That's you.
Yeah, no, I definitely am different than that guy.
And where does that come from? Like, just you make up a guy and kind of...
I mean, it's me, but I don't do the things I would do, usually. Some of it is playing out fantasies, like saying things out loud to people that are bothering me that I never would say.
My dumb questions are just, yeah. I'm amazed at people's creativity. See, I can't fathom being
able to
make shit up like that.
You're like a little boy, though. But are the cameras really there, or are you bringing them?
Wow!
But
I am an ass.
The kids on the show are actually two different girls played my youngest daughter last season.
Dick Sark, Sergeant, and Dick York.
That's right.
I almost fucked that up.
And it
I?
Wasn't far from that. They were very close. We had a girl playing. When I started doing the show, FX wanted to make my talent deals for me because they have these packages they give actors, you know. Really? And I said, I don't want to do that because I don't want you to know who I'm hiring. And
keep everything on the QT.
I want to do it
myself.
Yeah. You know, our little company hires our actors directly. And also, I don't want to give people series deals because I don't want to be forced to put them on the show.
Yeah.
I don't like having to say, oh, what are we going to have to make up for this guy this time? So the girls, you know, I hired two actresses to play my daughters. And the guy who runs FX said to me, yeah, but what if one of them gets another job? And I said, well, fuck her then. I'll get another one. I don't care.
No one cares.
No one gives a shit. It doesn't matter who's playing them. It really doesn't. And
you're fucking brilliant.
No, so one of the girls, well, the girl who played my youngest daughter, she got a pilot on ABC. It wasn't even a show that went to, I knew it wouldn't go to series because no pilots really ever do.
Mm.
But I said, let her go. We'll get another one. And then maybe if she comes back next year, you know. So she left, and then we got another one and started using her. And then the thing came up, well, this is what FX warned me of. Do I tell them that I replaced my daughter? And I decided, no, I'll just, they, because they don't see the show until it's complete. They don't see, read scripts, they don't see footage.
Oh, shit, okay.
So I figured they'll see an episode with the new kid, and then I'll get a phone call and I'll deal with it then.
They'll assume they've lost the part.
Yeah, so I put it on, I sent it to them. The first episode with the new girl, they didn't say anything.
They didn't notice?
They never noticed. And then one of the last episodes,
wow,
actually, both girls, because I matched two stories that weren't originally supposed to be. One girl plays my daughter in the first half of the episode.
She really pushed
and another
it,
girl
didn't you?
Plays her in the second half.
And no one
never
noticed.
No one said anything. And I finally talked to the FX guy and I said, did you know
that I've got
two girls? And he was like, no. And nobody, none of these fucking commenty, complainy cunts on the internet have ever picked up on it. Nobody, because who gives a shit?
It doesn't matter.
You know how hard it is to get creative control like that? Like, that's like a fucking Kubrick or Spielberg type of thing. Nobody has 100%. That's amazing, dude.
Well, and it's from being on the other side of the spectrum from those guys that we drove the show down to be so cheap that it's not like
they were just
Spielberg
happy.
Owns the world, so he can do what he wants. But me, no one cares what I'm doing because my show can be paid for by advertisers that literally don't know what the show's about.
It's perfect.
If the show was a little more expensive or on a little bit earlier, then, you know, I don't know who, Nescafe or, you know.
Nescafe.
General Mills.
General Mills would say,
Procter & Gamble.
Person? Yes, but right now, fucking some lawyer from New Jersey is paying for my show.
Changed out the fucking daughters and no one knew.
No, and also, I don't have that control by contractually. I don't have a deal that says I can do what I want. The deal that I have that I signed says that FX has full control over the show and that they have to approve every decision that I make.
But whether they do that or not is another
thing. In practice, they've never done it, but I earned that with every show. If I turn in two shitty episodes... I'll start having an executive on the set, and I'll have to turn in
fingers in there.
But how great is that they fucking allow that? That's like you're giving them a great product, and they're not fucking with
it.
That's,
alone.
So nice.
Well,
that's
the way I got it was that I was willing not to do the show any other way. I was willing to say no. You have to really be willing to say no to stuff. If you really want the gig and you feel like you can't live without it, then you'll give away everything.
And it's so rough when you're close.
Like, well, we want to read scripts. And I go, no, I'm not interested in you doing it that way. We established it with the pilot. I said, this is the only way I'll do it. You give me the money, I'll make a show. Well, we'd like to find out who's in it. Not interested in telling you that. Really? Yeah, no, and if you want to know who's in the show, then I'd rather not do it. Like, I said that a few times through the process.
And meant it.
Yes, I did, and I meant it. Well, we'd like to visit your set. I don't want you here. But I totally understand why you would want to come here because you're paying for the show. But I'd rather we just said call it off.
Wow.
And I just kept saying that. And they were so cool. And the guy who runs FX, John Landgraf, is a genius. And he said he kept everybody off of me. And it worked. I gave them a show they liked. If I'd given them a show that needed work, they would have been like, yes, we'll give you a green light, but you need more supervision. But they're like, do keep doing it that way. But he's the one who got me to do it without signing that. He said, look,
so
I can't.
Could have come up
there's
with,
no deal that exists like, that covers this.
So. Hitler, a love story you could have come up with.
You could have done anything.
I could have done anything. But since I turned in something that was basically funny and competent and didn't look crazy, okay, let's keep doing it as long as it works. But episode by episode, I have to earn that. Mm-hmm. So each episode. So far they've liked, and they just keep saying, "All right, it's good." They don't ever give me notes or anything. They just let me
stay hands off.
It's the best job I ever had. Well, and that gives me freedom not only to do what I want and be edgy. It also, I don't have a good work ethic. Like I can't complete things, and I don't have a consistent focus.
Wow!
So I can do things like write half a sketch on the show or half a story. And I can't get around to finishing it.
See
I go ahead and produce it anyway. I send it to get them to cast the parts, and I start shooting it without an ending.
It totally comes across. You totally come across to me as a guy that is the finish it guy.
Well, I do. Like, it takes me a long time to finish
eventually,
stuff.
But I mean, like to me, I really thought you were the kind of guy that like. Because from a lot of the short things I've seen you do online and things like that, it's like I have an idea and I'm actually going to do it. And you do it.
Some of them are like that. Some things that I've done, I know that I have an idea and 5 minutes later, I actually know how it's going to be shot and finished and everything.
So won't finish it sometimes. You'll have like you'll know where you want to start and kind of where you might want to end up and then just know it's going to work out.
Yeah. I'll just shoot a scene that I know is funny and then I'll find a place for it. It doesn't have a context yet.
Well, you got the confidence that you're
going to
get
there. Well, like in the episode on the show that's about religion, it starts with this thing of me going into a public restroom and there's a glory hole. And I didn't have a plan for that scene. I just liked the idea of this glory hole thing. and I started shooting it. We shot it and it was totally different. And then we shot it and I didn't like it, actually. And in the actual original version, the dude sticks his penis in this glory hole and he has this religious orgasm that I watch happen. And that was the original thing. And I watched it, and it was gross. It was
creepy
and weird and unfunny. And so I shelled it. I said, fuck this thing. I forgot. I mean, I have the ability to shoot something, and then no one ever sees it. So I figured I'm going to bury this. It'll never be on television. But then we started shooting the religion episode, and it hit me. This would be it. I could take just the beginning of that bit and have it just be a discussion starter.
Yeah, for a little intro kind of.
Yeah. So some stuff I shoot without knowing how I'm going to. Use it.
That's cool.
And there's been stuff that you shot that you probably haven't used, right? That you know,
there's whole bits that Nick DiPaolo, who's on the show a lot as himself. I originally put him in a suit and tie and had him play almost like a Catskills, like he did kind of a character, and he wore a suit and tie. Like, and I just like they had this weird idea that there's an old timey. Dean Martin kind of comedian in the midst of these.
What the fuck?
And I have one bit. one whole thing that I shot with him in that character. That never will be on the show, but it's on the DVD. It's on the DVD.
You put it in a nightmare scene for Nick.
Yeah,
yeah. Nick has a nightmare that that's who he is.
I was gonna say DVD would.
No, and also because I don't make serious deals with people, and because nobody cares who's on the show, I can like Bob Kelly. I hope he's. I mean, I should probably call him after to tell him.
No.
But Robert Kelly, who played my brother on the show, I didn't have any plans to have a brother on the show. Just I wrote one scene for him, and he really nailed it. He had that really pathetic quality to that Bob has, that you just want to punch him and hug him.
Oh, the diner scene's fucking fantastic.
And so he was so good in that, and that I gave him a few more episodes. This season, I might not have him on.
You're basically saying you don't have a brother anymore.
I don't have a brother, because I don't have a brother in real life.
Happy Days.
Yeah.
Hey, like, fat Chuck, how does that feel?
Can we call Bobby right now and tell him?
No.
You're Chuck.
No, I don't want to hurt him. He might.
He's tremendous. Bobby's great.
I'm writing season two. I'm writing season two right now, and I haven't written a bit for him, and I introduced a sister into the show because I have actually three sisters. So
it's with a wig.
A sister character. So he may not be on. But then the other day I came up with a bit. I thought that actually might be good for him. But he also might come back as a different character. I don't know.
Say that if
I'm serious.
Great.
You should have him come back as two people at once because he's put weight on just to humiliate him.
Exactly.
When he's in the car, though, it is such perfect Bobby when he's just like, hey, dude.
Hey,
dude.
No, Jim is in one scene last year. And probably I'll use him as a totally different guy. He's in his himself with a fucking necklace over his t-shirt like an asshole.
Necklace over the t-shirt. That was probably, that was my Lucky Louie thing that Pam gave me.
That's right.
That's the only reason I never wear jewelry. I hate jewelry. Right.
That poker scene was some great writing.
But I do Holy characters shit. Too. So if you need a character like a French guy or whatever.
Do you I'm have not, one of those
French
composite
one out?
Louie, I will be happy to be on.
Fucking good, man.
You know what would be great? French
would be to actually have him on as a French guy and say that he's a French guy and have him do that. To have it be like a French, like a bakery I go into, and he goes, oh, it's so nice to see you.
Louis.
Do the guy, like, hey, good morning.
I am so happy you came to my bakery.
How are the croissants this morning?
They are delicious and hot, just the way you like them.
All of a sudden you're German.
But there was a whole World War II thing in my family. I'm writing backstory.
Oh, he's Alsatian. Okay. He's Alsatian French.
Vichy.
I could almost totally see doing that.
Why not?
Just have him play this broad and don't just have it be this
no character. Explanation, no. Nothing.
Good. And maybe we have one of those, like, it's a character, we have one of those, it's been a tough day with the kids. You know, fatherhood is tough, right, Francois?
Oh, yes, it is tough to raise them properly. You have to let them go.
Fucking good, man.
He's got wisdom. He's got a little wisdom.
Yeah, a lot of wisdom.
You close your eyes, you can see the beret. Yeah.
If I turned that show on and I saw that, I'd shit my pants. I would shit my pants.
I'll just do really hacky French jokes. Well, if your children, you should surrender.
And just an aside.
Surrender.
You can see him just walking down the street and just say hello to him. And he's got the paper bag with a baguette sticking out of it.
Yes.
And some celery and a beret on.
But I'll have to make sure the audience knows. Like, you'll say something. I'm glad you came in because I am French.
See, I love the idea of doing this because, like, Ricky Gervais's character didn't fit the rest of the season at all because I didn't do any other cartoonly stupid characters like that. I did one. And there's people that complained about it, like, this doesn't fit. And I'm like,
really?
What? Fuck you. I mean, one thing I love to do on my show is that even the people that are the biggest fans of the show have things that make them upset about it. That makes me happy.
I never
like in the pilot when the girl
fit.
Gets in the helicopter and flies away.
Right,
a lot of people are like, that's where it really, it did really. So fuck you. I wanted to do it.
That's
my show.
Right.
If you don't like it, stop watching. If there's enough of you guys, I'll get fired.
That's what we say.
I don't give a
time.
Shit. So it would be great if next season is really down to earth and real.
and really, you know, just believable, incredible, but there's this one, one sore thumb piece of shit. Not even played by a guy who knows how to do it. Like, it would be bad enough to get a stereotypical French guy who actually is, you know, trained, but this guy doesn't even have any handle on the accent.
And you got, you
it's not what he's known for, to use Jimmy that way.
But you gotta go all in and have him in every episode just to really hammer the awfulness home.
Oh, that would be horrid.
Every fucking episode.
That would be great. It's like, what's his name? Will Ferrell told me that he used to have in his head these couple watching SNL, he would imagine, and he would do moments that he used to call holy moly moments, where the husband of the couple, he would do things on SNL that he pictured the guy going, holy moly. Like, Jesus.
What the hell is he doing?
That's what this is going to be.
That's a holy moly.
I think we're probably doing it too, so, Jim.
Jim, get ready.
I've been working on my French accent for fucking since about 8:48.
You gotta do it now.
Obnoxious thing
By the way, was that the pilot also that Chelsea was in?
Chelsea's the one who got in a helicopter.
When you open the door and pin her behind the door, that is one of the best awkward scenes ever.
Horrible. The thing that was amazing about that to me was that I wrote that, and then they went and I mean, I wrote it in the script. It wasn't something that we just sort of found.
Right.
I said that there's the door is too close to the stairs, and when he opens the door, there's nowhere for her to go but behind it. And so he holds it open, pinning her. I wrote that, and they had to go find the text.
Yeah, because now logistically, you got to find a door that
they
that
had
works
to scour
like
the East Village and find a building that was willing to let us shoot there that would have that
situation.
Yeah, without it looking like we forced it.
I do hate the awkward double door. Try to hold the door for the girl thing, because now she's in, and some girls know how to actually kind of stop there and wait.
Right.
And you could open it, but then most of them lunge for it and open, and now she's opening the door for you, and then you got to make the whole tit for tat joke.
Like, then you did it for me, which is
now
funny.
Now we're even.
Now we're laughing at unfunny moments.
Exactly.
You held it for me.
Door.
I can't open. Wait for this to be over.
Can't wait to fuck your ass and throw you out my window. Fucking moderately amusing cunt.
Moderately amusing cunt. That's some comedian should have that as a special. So Whitney Cummings next special. Sorry. Just picked one out of the hat.
I know. You just picked a woman.
Fair enough. Why not?
Picked a woman out of the hat. That's what I always do.
Hey, Louis, the open to the show, a guy flips off the fucking camera.
Yeah.
And there's some discussion about that, if you set that up or if that was real.
Oh, no, that was... If I had set it up, that would have been a shitty...
way to do it.
Yeah, but... No, when we shot that, the last night of the pilot shooting, we shot the stand-up at the Comedy Cellar. And we were figuring out as we were going along how to do that. And I got a Steadicam operator to stand on stage with me at the Cellar. That's how we shot that. And so you get that first-person feeling.
Mm, right.
It's the same way I shot the stand-up on Hilarious on the special that's out at 10 o'clock Sunday on Comedy Central, and then later on DVD.
And you do
and Netflix.
You do acknowledge the camera at one point.
Yeah, during the Hilarious special. Right, yeah, because he got too close.
Or, yeah.
And I could hear the guy's cans. I could hear the tech director talking to the camera person.
Okay, go to three. We're going to pack us in. And you're trying to fucking do
I actually hear her telling him what he's doing. Go get go a little closer. You can get closer, Joe.
Oh,
you can get closer.
It is
and I'm talking
moment,
to a fucking audience of 2,000 people during a set that I've been preparing for a year.
Yeah, I'm glad you left that in.
And I had to turn to him and say, you got to back off because I can hear you.
Yeah.
But we left it in because it is a strange... I think if you watch the show high, that's probably a really fucked up moment.
Because
you're just absorbed
weird.
In it.
Yeah, you feel like...
And all of a sudden you go...
You know, it would have been a funny thing to say, hey, Captain Obvious, you want to back up? I mean, I can think of this stuff later.
But back to the guy who flipped off the camera.
Okay, so... Sorry. Dying. Sorry. Okay, the guy... So we shot at the Comedy Cellar with a Steadicam. And then when we were done, I was standing out in the Village. It was the summer. And the Village in the summer is just so crazy. Active. And I thought, maybe I should shoot a moment outside. And then it hit me. I don't have an opening sequence to the show. I don't have a way to open.
And just to hand something into FX, just to give him something. I assume we'll shoot some kind of a really slick opening someday for this show. But just to have something to give them when we turn in the pilot, because they only gave us $200,000 to do the pilot, which is a lot, very low money for a pilot.
Yeah, yeah.
So we had a Steadicam guy there, which is a very expensive rig and person. And I said, why don't we just put the guy's Steadicam on with a 25 lens, doesn't matter. And and I'll walk from the Third Street subway to the Comedy Cellar, which is my walk. That's how I get to work every night. And just fall, you know, walk in front of me with the camera and just, we'll just shoot that. And so we're walking. We did exactly that. I came out of the subway. We only did it once. And he followed me. And then I just followed my instincts. I got to Ben's Pizza on McDougal Street and went in for a slice. That's why I always do get a couple of chomps.
Yeah.
Because usually what happens is I put my kids to sleep and then I get a babysitter to come and then I run to the cellar and I haven't eaten. I fed them dinner and put them to bed. So I just need a little bit of calories in me to do a set. So I started eating the pizza and the camera stayed there and just watched me eat pizza. And these young Asian kids with spiky hair, kind of like cool alt punky kids walk by and they see a camera. So they like think, oh, fuck you, like this kind of just, you know what I mean, young people contrary to anything.
Yes.
You know, fuck you, man. And the kid really did it like that, like you can't hear it because there's no sound, but he was stupid that he didn't, you know, he could have just stood in front of the camera
and really,
but as he walked by, yeah, fuck you, like he did it like that. And I just watched him and I kept a straight face. You can see me glance at him after he gives me the finger. And I thought, because I saw, I know the scope of the lens that we had on. I'm like, I know we just caught that. And I know it's out of focus. And I'm so happy that just happened. That's just so, and it was a moment that I thought, this show's going to be on TV. Like that moment,
yeah.
Literally, when he flipped off the camera, I thought, because I was like, that's so cool that that's going to be in the opening credits. And I knew this is going to be the opening credits of the show. I'm not replacing this. And I think we're going to get on the air. Like, it just made me believe.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Because of the fun, to me, the coolness of getting this middle, this legitimate, sincere middle finger in the in this New York City show.
That New York City moment.
One of the funniest things that happened on Lucky Louie to me was we were doing a scene and there was a woman who was a bartender. And she had a shirt on, and on the shirt was like the little clear tag that had like LLL, like for large.
Oh, yeah. You know, when it from the Gap.
Yeah, you always forget to take those off the back of your leg.
And
on your jeans.
We're rehearsing, and Louis goes to me, all I want is for that to be shot and on television.
Yeah.
I want that so bad.
Yeah. And it was, I think. I don't think we had to take it off.
I don't know if they took it off or they caught it, but you're like, I just don't want them to catch that.
Yeah.
I want her to have that on television.
Oh, no. I love when imperfect things happen. And awful things. And I go, we're using that. It's easier to do on this show than Lucky Louie. There was some level of people trying to perfect stuff all the time, and that used to make me irritated.
Look how easy it is to just pull shit up.
I was
very happy when it came on Netflix, by the way.
I love the open of this fucking show.
Yeah,
man.
This is just, I was really tired. We'd been shooting all day.
Yeah, you look very natural. Like, that's how you look walking.
And actually, it backs up if you know the geography of
the
village.
Yeah, you walked past it already, Lou. What the fuck?
There he is.
And then you give a little glance over to him. You did.
I just missed it. I looked down.
A little glance over, like, what the fuck?
Oh, yeah. There he is. Right on.
Fuck you!
Fuck you!
A camera! Fuck you, man!
That means anything.
Dude.
Yeah.
The camera represents the eye of the man.
No, and this font is just what was I used it for other shit.
Yeah.
And we kept it. I didn't. Yes, that's passed by about a block.
How much you have to pay for the song?
I'll tell you about that in a second because I couldn't afford the song.
Jeez.
Here comes the dude. And I look at him.
That's great.
And there's me looking at him going, awesome.
You just look
Thank
over.
You. Thank
I
you
just
for
look
that. Over
and
I'm
and
thinking,
then look
mm-hmm.
back.
No, like, and that moment of me looking is me thinking, this. I'm got my own TV show again. That's fantastic. I honestly felt that way.
Fucking
no, the song, and the song I picked off of iTunes or whatever and threw it on for the sake of the, you know, for just to, again, just to have something to hand in
as
a complete thing. And then John Landgraf, the guy who runs FX, when he saw it, he said, I think Louis fits into it. He And also, I didn't know I was going to call it that. I just did that as a thing. And he said, I think Louis fits in. I like the opening. I like the song. He took it as the way the show's supposed to be. And then I needed to go get, yeah. Then I needed to go get this song, Brother Louis, which actually, was originally recorded by a band called Hot Chocolate.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was re-recorded by the Stories. And so we went after it and our legal tiny department. And they said they would give us, well, yeah, there's the publishing and then there's the recording. The publishing is the actual, like, the song lyrics and the arrangement. And that costs us, we pay $5,000 an episode for that, which for us,
wow,
$300,000 show, that's a lot. That's a chunk of our budget.
Wait, is that, now, is that the publisher and the artist have to get the same thing, I think? That was a way to promote.
Well, some people own both separately.
Oh, yeah.
The master recording is a different group of people because actually we pay Hot Chocolate for the publishing or whoever owns their publishing because they wrote it. But the Stories version is the one that we wanted.
Okay.
Because of that guy, Louis, Ian Lloyd, that singer. The Hot Chocolate version is like eight guys going, Louis.
Yeah.
It's not as fun. So we recorded our own version of it. Reggie Watts was a comic.
Reggie.
He did the music for the first half of the season. And then we didn't have enough to finish it with, and we did it with other people. But he arranged and recorded the music for it that we did, which is almost identical to the Stories version.
Wow.
I think it's a little better. It's just a little nicer. And then we did a version where he sang it, where Reggie sang it, and it didn't work. And we tried to think of another way to create that sound, and we couldn't. I was in the studio with Reggie at like midnight, because all the music on this series, I do it with a group of musicians. It's all original music.
Wow, Jesus.
And when we were doing the theme song, it's like, how are we going to do this? And then I thought, well, whatever happened to the Stories? Like, whatever happened to the lead singer? So yeah, I went on the internet. Doing? Yeah, and I Googled Ian Lloyd.
Right.
First of all, I Googled the Stories. I don't know who the fuck he was at the time. And I found a YouTube video of him doing it on American Bandstand. And Louis! And so I Googled his name, and Ian Lloyd is just a guy living in New York City, and he has a band. It's his son's band, but he's like sings.
Jesus
Christ. And so he's got a little website that he obviously hadn't updated since like 1989 or something, and there's an email on it. So it's like midnight, and I write a Hail Mary email. Hi, I'm a TV producer, and I want to hire you to do a job. Write me if you're interested. And the next morning, I wake up to an email. This is my current email.
Please help
This
me.
Is my phone number. And he gave me his phone number. So I call him up, and he's the fucking greatest guy in the world. And he's just happy to still be singing.
Yeah.
And I kind of asked, sort of carefully, do you still have the pipes to do what you did on the song? He said, sure, I do. And I told him, look, here's the thing. Oh, because the song, when we went to try to get it, it was like fucking $20,000 an episode they wanted for the recording.
For the recording of it,
they wouldn't back down, and we can't afford it. So I went to Ian, and I said, can we just hire you as a singer for a day? That's all I can really afford to do. I have no money for this show. And he said, well, I need you to pay me enough that I don't want to kill myself. He said, basically, I'm happy to do this for you. I just need to have some self-respect, you know? So I offered him some money, and he said, that's fine. And he showed up. It was one of my favorite experiences ever on the show, because he was such a good guy, and he remembered how we recorded it. He remembered, there's a couple of tracks, and he harmonized with himself, and he helped us with it. And the only thing, I had him do it exactly the way he did it in the original, and his voice is a little older, but I like it that
but
ours
it
is a little different. And also,
yeah.
I asked him to say, instead of Louis, you're gonna cry, the second time he says, Louis, you're gonna die. I just asked him to make that one change, which he did.
Wow.
And he nailed it. So we have a version that zero people believe is anything but the original Stories version. Without having to pay that money, which would
episode.
Be going to Ian Lloyd. Unfortunately, he probably fucked himself.
He fucked himself over.
No, and I felt bad because when I did Carnegie Hall, I had this idea to have him sing live to introduce me. And I thought that would be so cool. And he'd go crazy singing Carnegie Hall. I'm sure he didn't see that coming in his future.
Yeah.
And And but they, the people at Carnegie Hall, if you do music, they charge you like you're the fucking symphony orchestra. Like they get like you're the Philharmonic. So I couldn't afford it, but they printed the programs that says with special guest Ian Lloyd on my Carnegie
Collector's
Hall.
Item.
But no, he's a great guy, and he, yeah.
Goddamn,
but there's been people on the internet that are like, this can't be the Stories version because they that says you're gonna die, and I have the Stories version. I've listened to both back to back.
They don't notice the daughter change, but they notice that fucking shit.
Yeah, that's Wait, Luke, could you have him sing live if you had a recording, or is it just if music's being played?
It
like
was,
if you had the music taped.
Well, at that point, I wanted to have like a little combo band, and then they said that would cost a lot, and then they said, well, you could. You could do it with playback, and then I said, "Well, I just don't want to do it." So you just look, called me out on a lie. I really just kind of backed out on hiring, but I never told him I was going to hire him.
For comparison, we got the original.
Oh yeah, okay.
Right at the hook, the Stories version.
Yeah,
little slower.
He's a little grittier now. A little more in his voice.
All right, and then where's
what made you think of this song for the show?
Yeah.
Thank you, Luke.
Danny, you got the the other one?
Buddy.
What?
Oh, you want me?
No, yeah, you got the...
No, the original from the open.
From the open?
Louie, your version, your version's way better.
I think I
you
like
really
it
You really updated it.
Let's see.
Here we go.
My bad.
This opening is from the Hot Chocolate version. They open this way. The Stories version is more 70s stringy in the beginning. Yeah, there's more strings here.
Yeah.
It sounds almost like,
sounds good.
What's the guy who did, Fred is Dead?
Fred is Dead. That's what I said.
Yes, like that. Who is that guy?
Was this a popular song?
Yeah,
it was a hit.
Oh, I think, Curtis Mayfield, I think.
Curtis Mayfield. The music is a little Curtis Mayfield.
Wow.
That string's
wow, Louie.
I always thought that I thought that was the original lyric.
No.
Until right this moment.
Doesn't exist in the original.
That's fucking
Your version's way better.
I love him, this crooning singer saying, you're going to die. You're going to cry.
What a great anecdote.
Yeah, usually those back scenes things are boring. That was a pretty good
one. Was very.
And you fucked that guy over.
Man, you totally
really fucked him over with his help.
You so fucked
with
his
help. Yeah.
He has horrible representation.
He would start getting checks from ASCAP.
Right.
He'd become. They'd be coming every time
every
the show
time
is on
the
Netflix.
Everything.
Fucking DVD. Boom, boom. Oh, instead, he got a day rate.
You had such a great experience with the guy, but you fucked him over.
No, Ian Lloyd. He's a good man. I always get emails from him when he's in town and stuff.
Put him in an episode.
He's a good man. No, I'm going to. He also wants to act, too, so I'll put him in something.
How old is he?
I have no idea.
Is he black or white?
50s. White guy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Scrawny white guy.
Yeah.
With a voice. Nobody has that voice. I mean, that's a testament to what he did that fucking 30 years later, I couldn't find anybody that could replicate that sound. There's no white guy.
That is amazing, yeah.
What is that?
Yeah.
What kind of, there's no, it's not soprano or something. It's just,
heroin.
Yeah. Oh, that's him right there?
Yeah.
Hey, he looks all right. Hey, listen.
Like
he's awesome.
Why don't we take a break?
Fishing captain.
Louis, you're going to make it to the end with us or do you got to go
somewhere?
Yeah,
I'll hang around.
Okay, good. Louis C.K. He's here to promote Hilarious, which is going to be on Comedy Central Sunday night at 10 p.m. And then it'll be available on CD and DVD Tuesday. Hilarious is great. More
Thank
with
you.
Louis C.K. Stay there. C.K., I don't know if what we were just talking about is worth talking about on the air, but I was telling Louis, when I walk around in my dumb life, so many people come up to me and tell me one of their favorite episodes of Louis' show was the one where he follows the kid home that kind of threatened him in the donut shop. And then the episode ends with Louis just kind of hanging out on the stoop with the kid's father. He follows him all the way to Staten Island. And it's not a lot of laughs in there, but people love that episode. But it also, you were saying, frustrates or pisses off people because they weren't laughing.
Yeah. I mean,
I don't get that.
Well,
because that could have been my favorite episode.
I think it was one of my favorite ones. I mean, I don't look at stuff on TV as segregated comedy or drama.
Right.
Like, most things actually that are sold as comedies don't make me laugh. Like,
right.
I haven't watched a comedy movie
that's really made me laugh. To me,
You didn't go see the Flockers movie? Come on, Lou.
Yeah, that's a movie made for you, Lou.
It's funny because Robert De Niro, his comedies are so bad, but his dramas are hilarious. To me, two of the funniest movies in history are Goodfellas and Raging Bull. Mm-hmm. Two hilarious movies, not sold as comedies. They're not supposed to be funny.
What was the last comedy you laughed at? Do you remember?
Fuck, I don't know. Maybe Dumb and Dumber.
Wow.
Like, that made me laugh just because of how dumb and dumber
it was.
Yeah, exactly. But other than that, I haven't really laughed at a lot of sometimes I watch Family Guy. Mm-hmm. On Netflix to fall asleep. Like, it's something that actually helps me fall asleep. And it makes me laugh really hard. But there's something... because it's a cartoon, I think it's just because it's the cartoons put me to sleep. Because it's one-dimensional and it has...
Sure.
A sing-songy way of it. The Family Guy has these voices that talk like, dang it, man, man. So it kind of puts me to sleep.
It's kind of funny actually, that you say that.
And I kind of hated it the first time I saw it because it's so jokey. But but I gave it a chance because you should
love the characters.
When you adjust to something you're not used to. That's what a lot of people just won't do that. They're like, this isn't what I am sure is already good, so I hate it.
This is not what I'm used to.
But if you make an adjustment, and actually if something's not what you're used to, then you might find a new thing to laugh at, which there's nothing better in life. And if Family Guy does that for me, it surprises me with a constant stream of jokes. I go to sleep.
You made a great point during the break when we were just chit-chatting. You said you like being surprised by
things. That's the best thing you can do.
Fuck yeah.
Is to find entertainment or humor or intrigue in a location of people's minds that they haven't found it before.
And it goes back to that poker scene you did, which Jim Norton's in and all the guys, where you guys are just busting each other's balls.
Yeah, it starts as just... And also, because it was early in the season, I liked that people would be... I mean, I'm aware of where the context of an episode now, from having done... Lucky Louie taught me a lot as far as, like, just coming on TV all of a sudden.
Sure.
And what that means. So I knew people would be like... They'd start watching the poker scene thinking, okay, so we're going to once in a while see Louie and his buddies playing poker. This is an introduction. And they banter... And they make gay jokes because that's just what fellas are like. And then that episode just stumbles into this fucked up territory. And then all of a sudden you're not laughing and you're watching this guy talk about this thing. And then I make a joke in the middle of it, which is really inappropriate. And so it's wait a minute, am I supposed to be laughing at this or not?
Right.
And then it goes away. The episode isn't even about that. And we never saw that group of guys again.
I fucking hate you. I'll tell you why. Because you just explained what I thought. Like, okay, the poker.
Yeah, but hate's not the way to deal with it.
No, I hate Louis. But I thought you were going to keep going back. That would be a central thing of your show.
Right.
Absolutely. I bought into that. Like, okay, they're going to be doing poker every once in a while.
Right.
To just kind of have a little fun and beat
each
other
again.
Up. And it never happened again.
No.
You surprised me with that.
We might in season two have another poker game. I don't know.
Right.
I don't know.
But you didn't have to go there again.
No, I didn't have to. And again.
Other shows would have.
Every show.
Because there were some lines that were
every show would have done it.
Definitely.
You should have done something like we were playing cards and someone should have said liquor in the front, poker in the back, and just give you a little finger like that.
A little finger on the side.
Yeah, a little joke.
That would have been good.
Yeah.
I mean, we'll come back and do that. No, and we didn't come back to it, and other shows would have been pressured by a network to do. We love the poker,
please,
guys.
Please do more poker, right.
Let's hear...
Yeah, that's
what Eddie Brill has to say this week. Maybe he gets sad.
Yeah.
Oh, they would.
And then,
have
and not only would they do
that.
Poker, but every episode,
would
every poker scene would start with guys razzing each other and then getting serious. It would have happened over and over.
Same exact way. Oh,
right.
God. They just know how to unfunny shit up.
There was originally a second scene to the poker thing, and we shot it, and I didn't use it, which is that at the end, it was going to be kind of bookends, that at the end of the episode, I'm on stage. Because I used to do the bits about the word faggot, cunt, and nigger. Like, that was my chunk of inappropriate words bits that I did then.
Inappropriate?
Yeah, a little bit.
Oh.
A little bit. And so I do the poker thing to address the word faggot. And then you see me on stage doing my bit about nigger and the N, people saying N-word instead of nigger and that stuff. And then Hannibal Buress, who's in the poker scene, the black comedian, comes up to me and goes, hey, man, you know... I see you banished faggot from your act, but you got nigger going strong. What's up with that? And I'm like, well, I don't mean it. That was like, yeah, no, I get it. But, you know, I hear Rick say all this stuff. Do I have to now explain to you what nigger means? Does that, you know? And I'm like, geez, come on, man. And he's like, I'm just saying, if you're going to say nigger, say faggot. I mean, it's not fair. So we actually
good.
We actually shot it and then didn't use it
because the sound was shitty and just didn't
oh really
work. Yeah, otherwise I probably would have kept it.
How great is it the network lets you say nigger and faggot though is in the right context. It's just great that they don't fucking bother you. Yeah.
Well, they
it's so
they
nice.
The standards person at FX is really smart, and she calls me whenever we, you know, that poker scene was much dirtier at one point.
Really?
And John Landgraf, the FX president, called me and said that he loved the scene and that he wanted to put it early in the run so that it would get reviewed and it would be part of what people would notice about the show. He said, but it's too dirty. He said, if you want to keep it as dirty as it is, we have to bury it like 12 episodes deep.
Wow.
Because it was so, just cum, every other word, cum, cum, suck cock cummy, up cum, the cum. Ass, eat dicks, cum. And he said, if you can tone it down in just the amount of times you use those words, then and he said, but it's totally your choice. He said, I think it's worth it because then that episode will get, that's a weighty scene and it's worth doing. So I went through it to see if I could cut it down without hurting it. And I cut out, like, this part where I go, where I say, how come you have to wear shoes at the club? And Rick says, because the floor gets full of cum. And Nick DiPaolo goes, all right, we get it. And so I cut him, I manufactured a cutoff where Rick goes, well, the floor gets full of, all right! And he cuts him off and doesn't let him say it.
Right.
I manufactured that in the editing, and I realized, you know what, this is actually making the scene better.
Sure.
That Nick gets nervous enough about the stuff that stops it from being said.
Yeah.
And I used that way of cutting it down. I didn't have to cut out as much as I thought I would. And I showed it to Landgraf, and he said, we can do that. And I'm so glad we did, because that episode is partly the reason the show got notoriety.
And that scene's gone viral for you.
Yeah, and there's this website for gay people called afterelton.com. It's a very big gay website. And they called me up, this guy called me up and said, well, I don't understand how this scene talking about gay people came from a straight guy. He's like, and he wanted to know how a straight person ends up with this point of view. Oh, maybe I'm gay. I don't know. I haven't sucked a dick yet.
Yeah.
But hey, if I'm a closet gay, let me find out soon. I'm almost fucking 50. Now, get it out in the open so I can start taking advantage.
But FX
how awesome would that be? All of a sudden, open your fucking horizons. But
at 50, just go fuck it.
To go, oh my God.
Why not?
There's twice as many people I can fucking.
Well, why not? Apparently, that's exactly what was tweeted on my fucking Twitter yesterday.
Yeah,
it said, for the new year, I'm going to try buy so I could double my choice out there.
Yeah.
Because I had left my my iPad out, and Keith the cop was over the house and decided to tweet.
Really?
As me.
Is that what you're saying?
Or,
yeah,
that's exactly what it
wow.
was.
Wow.
Yeah, it said, in the new year, I resolved to try buy. I mean, why not double my odds? And that's what he fucking does.
Well, that's what a friend does.
And sure. I had to put Jesus fucking Keith, got my Twitter again. I'm not trying to be bi. I really need to sign out of Twitter when I'm asleep.
Why did you need to dispel that, though?
Yeah, you should just left it out there.
What do you hurt? How are you hurt by that?
Well, I'm so homophobic that I I'm so insecure about my own masculinity that I feel I have to do that. I don't know why. Now that I'm reading it, I'm like, yeah, why the fuck did I feel compelled to do that? I think it's more of a, I just want to, like, give a fuck you to Keith.
Sure.
More so than having to explain. I don't think I had to explain that I'm, again, nearing the big 5-0 mark and just deciding I want to be bi. I don't think I really had to explain that. More so it's, look at what asshole Keith did again.
I remember I was did a show years ago with a guy named Tony V. Do you know Tony V? He's a comic from Boston.
I don't know.
Very funny guy. And we did the show. He's a really big guy, dressed as kind of like a biker, but he's also kind of weird. So he was wearing paisley boots, like colorful paisley boots, and then a biker jacket. And we were doing a show in Rhode Island. And some guy yells out, it was at a college. And this kid yells out, faggot. At Tony V, big burly guy, and goes, what? He goes, look at your boots, you faggot. And Tony goes, well, let's examine that for a second. What if I was a faggot? What if I was gay and I decided I wanted to take you out back by my car and force you down over the hood of my car and fuck you in the ass. If I had decided to do that, you know what you could do about it? Nothing. There's nothing you could do. I'm bigger than you. I'm smarter than you. I would just take you. And he goes, so you better pray I'm not a fag. You better hope you're wrong, man.
It's a great way to handle it.
Yeah. Who cares if somebody thinks you're gay? I really couldn't care less. If there was some way something came out that I was gay, I would never... I'm here to declare that these allegations are false. I just go, yeah, all right.
I want to say that.
Yeah,
who cares? Yes,
honestly,
I'm gay.
I'm not backtracking because we make enough dick suck jokes in this place and self-deprecating homo jokes and stuff. But I think it was more of a just, oh, fuck, look, asshole got my fucking Twitter account again. And.
Mm-hmm.
Did that.
I never care what people think. You know, you make up a few tranny stories, people start to think that it's real.
Yeah.
Oh, those oopsie.
Wacky people.
Oops.
Sure
oops.
They do.
We got a lot of people that want to say hi to Louis. Now that you're a big star, Louis.
Yeah.
He's really famous.
Yeah.
I just keep looking at him. He's so famous.
I've just kind of crossed over to a place where I'd have to go through infamy to get out now. Like, yeah. I'd have to do something bad.
Really bad. Yeah, yeah.
Otherwise, it's going to be just be a half-life, like uranium. It'll be...
I think we kind of...
No, the truth is, the show... I already see the road back down. This season of the show, everyone says it's just not as good as the second. People love...
To do that.
People love taking shows with promise, saying, you know what? Wasn't as good.
Sophomore jinx.
John Landgraf gets fired. Third season, I'm off the air. Mm. I go back on the road. I'm not as inspired as I've been in the past. I put out one shitty special.
Oh,
and
man.
It's over. I'm back at the Tempe Improv for $3,000 a week.
This leads to
I already
movies.
Know the
nah, it leads to movies low.
And I know I can't handle the Tempe Improv at $3,000 a week at this point. So I don't have
yourself.
A good so I go back the next year and they're like, we don't even want you. And then I'm teaching
That's
college.
Terrible.
Maybe if I'm lucky, teaching college.
You drive by all the theaters to get to the local comedy club. Remembering the days when you're at the theater.
And fucking, Daniel Tosh doesn't say hi to me when he walks by. Daniel, hey, what's up?
Hey.
No, I'm not a fan. I'm actually a comic. Okay, it's fine. No, Daniel, remember I used to know you.
Fine.
Okay, all right. Daniel can't talk to you right now. No, I know him. No, I know Daniel Tosh. I do.
What's worse than that phony, like, hey, man, how you doing? Oh,
yeah.
Oh, man.
Really?
Really?
Oh, it's fucking really? Horrible.
Oh, man, yeah.
Oh, it's brutal.
Yeah, it's Jim. Jim, no, of course, Jim.
Hey, I want to go to the phones because a lot of people want to say hi to Louis C.K. Right. The big special is this Sunday at 10 p.m. on Comedy Central. Hilarious. And it will be available on DVD and CD Tuesday, January 11th. Let's say hi to Howard in Miami. Howard.
Louis, love the show.
Thank you, Howard.
Hey, tell us about your Sarah Palin tweet.
Yeah, you kind of talked about it earlier.
Yeah, where you been?
Sarah Palin,
just,
yeah.
I didn't hear
I was just drunk, and she fascinates me. That's all.
Yeah, where
that's
you
it. That's
you
the
you
story.
Don't think she has a real shot, right?
No, I think she could get nominated.
Yeah.
And then lose.
Yeah.
She has no shot at winning the presidency.
No, I don't think so.
She's not a good enough debater. And honestly, she's not. I don't think she's bright enough to play on that level. And I'm not shitting on her. But I just don't think
I think she
can.
Knows that, too. And she's just kind of enjoying the attention everyone gives her.
Well, I
don't think she even believes in
she's
herself.
She's smart enough that she's... I don't think... Well, she didn't even want to be governor.
Right.
No, she didn't
right.
want to do it.
She's doing a reality show now. Because of shit.
Yeah. But I don't know. Under the right circumstances, something weird could happen. I mean, I'm not saying that she's... Like, I called her the new Hitler on Twitter once, and the person from FX said, you can't compare her to a person who killed 6 million Jews. And I said, well, I'm not comparing her to that. I'm comparing her to, like, early Hitler.
Early Hitler.
Yeah, the way that Hitler wrote, there is a comparison. It doesn't mean she's going to end up killing the same amount of Jews.
Early Hitler, the
but
first
she's
couple of seasons.
Starting out a very similar way, which is to be extremely inflammatory, go to the right of the right wing, which is what she did, attack the conservatives as not being conservative enough, and create this reactionary fucked up party and take a few seats in the legislature and then take a few seats more And I mean, this is what Hitler did. Hitler was elected to power. People forget that.
Oh yeah, they loved
him. He took the Reichstag in little pieces, and then they started doing stuff like all of them would stand up and walk out during votes so that nothing could get done.
Mm-hmm.
And then he created a fake explosion and fire in the German capital and said it was terrorism. And then based on that, they created emergency measures, and then he got reelected, and then he made himself Führer. Yeah. She could do that.
Führer.
It's easier to do with a parliamentary system like they have in Europe.
Yeah, it's a little rough.
President is harder to take.
I think
that way.
Yeah, I think it's kind of tough. It's easier for somebody to rise to power in the presidency like Castro or Obama did. Look, I have to bash.
Yes.
I have to bash.
Totally. I understand.
The socialist.
All right, let me see.
I understand.
Let's go to Jersey. Eddie.
Hey, guys, good morning.
Good morning.
First time caller. Love the show.
Thanks. Hi, Eddie.
Listen, Louie.
Yeah.
There's a scene you shot in one of the episodes at the airport. I wish you guys had played. It was one of the funniest things I've seen, and I'm 57, so I've been watching TV since you had to get up and change the channel.
Mm.
So,
it's a long time, Eddie.
Yeah, I know. But you got the guy at the counter losing his mind, but he's just out of the shot. I think you can just see his wife. And watching your face cringe as the guy is screaming at the counter, it was hysterically funny, and you got to do more of that.
Oh, thanks, man. Yeah, that happens all the time to me in airports and stuff. Somebody that's not in your world just fucking has a horrible moment, and you just get to see it.
Mm-hmm. Well, the funny thing is, I just got stranded out in Wisconsin last weekend trying to get back. So, I mean, and I'm thinking about that episode, actually, as I'm standing there trying to make reason of why I can't get home. But
how long you been flying, Eddie? Probably a long time, right?
Since the Wright brothers, dude.
They invented the airplane, so that means a long time.
That's a long time.
Jimmy, by the way, I want to thank you. You met my son the last time you were down at the Borgata. You treated him real nice.
Oh,
and he didn't even bother you for a picture, so thanks a lot, Jim.
Oh, you're welcome. Of course, man.
And Jimmy's going to be back at the Borgata, right, Jimmy?
I know
you're not promoting, but the guy mentioned
it. With Brewer, Attell, and Burr. Yeah, the first two are sold. The third one has a few tickets available at the Late Show Friday.
That's great.
We're all going down there, too.
That's great.
I want to ask Louie about the Huckleberry Finn thing.
What about Huckleberry Finn?
They're taking the N-word out of the book.
Oh, yeah. There's a whole documentary about that PBS did.
What?
You could probably get it on PBS website or something. They did a whole documentary about Huck Finn.
Uh-huh.
And that Nigger Jim is the name of the character. Right. And that once in a while, this happens. This is a cyclical thing. That's why everybody should see this documentary.
Mm.
That every once in a while, since the book was written, like Mark Twain, there's actually a quote from him where he says, I knew that when I wrote Huck Finn, he would cause a lot of trouble and that he will throughout history. Like that every once in a while, some fucking college student reads it and goes, that says nigger or not. That's really like, offensive.
Comes around like nigger's
and starts a thing. Yes. Some fucking nigger. Yeah. So there's actually, in the documentary, there's a great moment where Reagan is giving a Mark Twain Award to somebody or something like that. And he goes, and who can forget Huck Finn and his great friend, Jim. And there's a moment where he looks to the side and you can tell there's an aide waving his arms around.
No!
Like he said to him 50 times, Mr. President, don't when you give this award, say Jim, not, but it's nigger Jim. I read it. I haven't read much, but it's nigger Jim. Mr. President, you can't say nigger anymore. What? Why not?
Why not?
They don't like it. Oh, fine. Okay. Like so then, he was doing practicing for the teleprompter and his friend nigger Jim. Mr. President, please don't say nigger. I'm telling you right now, it's going to be the end for you. Oh, well, fine. Goodness
Jim.
Gracious. It's nigger Jim. That's the fellow's name.
Then he
and
started
so then you can
worse.
See, and he goes, and his friend Jim in the place
yeah,
of
that's great.
It should say instead in the when they reprint it, Jim. Every time it's supposed to say nigger Jim.
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 Or they should just put fucking in front of it.
Yeah, fucking black Jim.
No, just fucking
black
Jim.
fucking owned by another person face.
In a different font, so it really
there's nothing
out.
More ignorant.
than thinking you're fixing anything.
Thank you.
By taking Nigger Jim out of Huck Finn.
But
it was a fucking, it's a fucking monument to American history. This is what, and the book is about a kid's struggle with the what, if you've read Huck Finn, which I haven't, the point of it, no, I read it at some point, but the point of it is that this kid, Huckleberry Finn, has this friend.
Yeah, Jim.
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 Who's a slave, and he's his friend, and he grew up with him, and he wants, Nigger Jim wants him to help him to escape slavery. Mm-hmm. And the kid has been raised that that's wrong, that Nigger Jim is a slave and he belongs to somebody else, and to help him would be stealing, would be like corroborating with a theft to take away. That's what people were raised. And he has an internal struggle of, but I know him, he's a human being, and I don't know what to do about it. And to take away Nigger out of the Nigger Jim's name just fucking destroyed. It's like pretending he wasn't a slave.
Yeah.
It would be like rewriting the story and just saying Jim was an employee of the Home Depot who wasn't paid much and he was thinking of getting another job. But Home Depot's really, you know, their contracts are really strict. So Huck Finn had to help him get a job at IKEA.
And that's,
no, he was a fucking slave who was whipped, and his name was Nigger Jim. That's how bad his life was.
Yes,
so if you take Nigger out of Nigger Jim's name, you're softening the reality of what life was about. Like then.
And
you're taking away what was great about Mark Twain's humor.
Right.
Is that he reduced the misery of not only black people, but of all poor people in the South. He took that context and made colorful, beautiful, funny stories inside of that kind of this barefoot kid who's fucking starving.
He's a
dynamic, interesting character, and his friend Nigger Jim has a voice. Nobody else was writing for Nigger Jim.
Softens the whole conflict that the kid is feeling too, by because then it's like, oh, it's just Jim.
Yeah, it's just his friend Jim. No, this guy's bad life is so bad that he actually has to say, hi, my name is Nigger Jim.
Right.
Like, he actually has to answer to Nigger Jim.
Yeah.
But now it's Slave Jim, and eventually they'll get rid of Slave.
How about this? Would it be acceptable?
Make it, call Servant or something else.
Yeah, exactly. After?
Jim the you-know-what.
And eventually, it'll just
be Black Jim, like people just say it about people at work.
Yeah.
Just Black Jim.
The black guy. You know, Black Jim.
Yeah. But who is offended by this? Because I spent a lot of time on Twitter. Because
just niggers.
I wanted to send you off there. Perfect.
I don't know.
But it's
usually white people.
Yeah. You know what? I was on Twitter a lot yesterday looking at this because it was a trending topic. No one was offended that was commenting on it. Black people weren't offended. White people weren't offended. Equally, people were like, why are they doing this?
Yep. I thought it was financial. My take was because this book company is doing it.
But and then they're out of touch because
I think that's very shrewd, Jim. I think that every time they do a new edition of Huck Finn, they go, roll out the fucking nigger thing to get it out on the store, you know, to get these sell some books.
And they're afraid people might not buy it with nigger, and especially the climate now. So like, we want to sell books, change it like that, and maybe schools that aren't buying it will buy it. I think it's a financial
thing. Putting nigger in a book just shuts down sales.
Colleges and schools.
No, I know.
But Twitter is huge. And I'm telling you, I didn't see one person go, well, they should take it out. They were all like, what the fuck is this about?
Well, who's talking about taking it out now? The publisher? Are they talking about
the new publisher is taking it out.
The New South.
Without really giving a reason. I haven't seen a reason yet why they're taking it out.
No, it's really...
They said it was actually based on one guy complaining and talking about it, that whenever he had to talk about the book... He did the Jim.
How fucking important is that? And you should say Nigger Jim when you talk about the book. You should, if you're talking to sixth graders about it, you should say Nigger Jim every time. You should never say Jim without nigger in
any
life.
Context. Sports,
Nigger Jim.
On this show in the morning when I say hi in the morning.
Anthony with Nigger Jim.
Yeah, that's your new name, Jim.
Nigger Jimmy Norton. Little Nigger Jimmy Norton.
Oh,
Jesus, Lou, you got to show on FX. You're going to get an
FX. No,
effects,
but you shouldn't. That's how you untie those two, you're doing a real fucking damage.
Yeah, that's,
I agree.
It is softening.
Completely agree.
Completely.
And they'll continue softening it. They won't stop by with just naming him Slave Jim.
No.
They'll move on from there. Hey, a quote from Mark Twain about censorship. Censorship is telling a man he can't have a steak just because a baby can't chew it.
That's very, very Mark Twain of him.
That is Twain.
Can you find Mark Twain about Huck Finn? Because he said, find Mark Twain talking about Huck Finn.
Yeah, I would love to know.
If you Google, also YouTube around and see if you can find that Ronald Reagan clip, because I swear to God, it's what I, you know, it always ends up being something I didn't know.
What a great quote.
That's a good one.
Censorship is telling a man he can't have steak because a baby can't chew it.
Right.
That is fucking genius.
Sacrifice Ant said this years ago, our own entertainment, because we got to protect the children.
Yeah, the children.
But what happens to
what about our entertainment?
A baby is also about other adults. Metaphorically
that's
as well.
Definitely used as a metaphor.
Absolutely.
For asshole children. What I'm thinking.
I never read that. I don't read Mark Twain. I've never read him.
Oh,
I mean,
Jimmy.
I'm just not.
Neither
just,
do I.
Oh, that's a great quote. Yeah. That stopped me in my tracks. And I'm hard to do, as everybody says, no one doesn't stop in their tracks like Norton. That's what the word on the street is. People who think other people have different impressions of them than they do. Well, everybody's like, people always know. I don't fuck around. Nobody knows that. Shuck off.
Nobody knows that.
And in other news, it's official, according to CSA Dick, the Cleveland Cavaliers have offered that homeless guy the job of announcing at the fucking Cleveland Cavaliers. No,
Cleveland
games.
Needs something.
Yeah, that guy is
poor guy though.
A really good job.
See, he turns it down because he doesn't want to live in Cleveland.
Right.
You know, maybe he wants to go somewhere warmer.
Well, that too, Chip.
Just ruined your brilliant joke.
Oh, fuck him.
Yeah, well, what are we doing? We're looking up the clip.
I was trying to find the Ronald Reagan clip. That's going to be a hard thing to find.
I'm going
to.
Yes.
It was a PBS documentary. I'm going to watch that today.
Yeah.
Can I watch it on YouTube?
Netflix?
It's kind of difficult to find, actually.
How about Netflix?
Later I will. I got to
look. Well, when I did a preliminary search, it wasn't really yielding a lot besides VHS tapes.
What's that?
What's the special called, the documentary?
I don't fucking remember.
I'll get it for you. Hang on.
Someone can help me out and let me know.
That's all right. Sometimes we snap.
I don't.
It is called Culture Shock. Born to Trouble, Adventures of Huck Finn. That's the name of it, but it's kind of hard to find. Because it's 10 years old already.
Right.
I'll see. So, yeah,
I'm surprised
right.
YouTube doesn't have a...
I know, I just it might be on there, but not under that title anyway.
Right, right.
Is it on Netflix, Dan?
I need to look for it, because...
Please.
I'm doing something else now.
Let me say hi to Jerry in Maine. Jerry!
Hey, boys, how are you?
Pretty good, buddy.
All right.
Louie. It's a great show, and
You know what? Hold on 1 second.
Uh-oh.
We will go back to you in a sec. Kyle in California is a black guy, very angry. Kyle, what's up?
Hey, good morning, guys.
Good morning.
Hi, Kyle. How you doing? I'm Kyle.
And you're...
He's laughing.
What's up, Kyle?
I want to say I love the show, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you guys, like, if Patrice was there, you guys would use, like, your fucking nigga quota this morning. Like, this shit is ridiculous. Louis, I love your show, too. My wife and I watch it all the time. Genius. But who made the point saying that to take out the word nigga Jim out of takes away from the story? I didn't catch who caught that.
No, it's not... It would take away from it would take away from the story, but it also take away the historical context of it.
Kyle, let him finish. He makes a good point.
It would be sanitizing history in a way that that in the end is bad for black people. I think.
He was a slave.
Yeah, I know.
So how does taking the word that in highly offensive word, mind you?
Because he wasn't just a slave, he was called Nigger Jim.
Everything about his life.
That's how horrid it was. It takes away from the horror of what this guy's life was.
And also, Kyle, let me ask you something. When you read something, you should be hit with a visceral reaction. Like, Slave Jim, it's a horrible thing to be a slave, but that doesn't give you a visceral reaction. When you read
Jim, if you knew anything about what slavery was really entailed, it doesn't matter what you call it.
You have 1 minute left on your phone card. You have 1 minute left on your phone card.
Kyle,
I'm gonna wrap it up.
Let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question. Because we've said what we think about it. If you want to add something, what would be accomplished by taking Nigger Jim out of the book?
I think the fact, and I agree with you on censorship, it's diluting our society. And that quote that he had saying, if you take steak away from a man, it's like you're stopping a baby from eating.
Kyle, what would be accomplished? Did you take him off?
No.
What would be accomplished? What positive would come out of taking Nigger Jim out of a book like Huck Finn?
The positive that I feel would be accomplished, would set a standard as far as what's acceptable in our society. And I agree with you as far as censorship. But
it's not about censorship. It's about telling.
Somebody said it was part of a great part of American history, right? That book stems from a great part of American history. It's part of American history.
Right.
That was a very dark and disgusting time in our history.
Should we go back and change what it was really like?
Right.
I don't think
it should be celebrated.
Kyle,
should we redub it's not being celebrated, it's being illumined motherfucking nated. Grow the fuck up, man.
Should Roots be edited a certain way?
Should we redub Schindler's List and everywhere that they say Juden, say respectfully Jews, no problem with them, but let's go ahead and kill them. But let's not go and call them Juden.
I knew you would bring that point up as far as how the Jews were treated. Even the Japanese in World War II would call them chinks and whatever you call them, flat faces, who knows? I understand your
point. Dude, should Roots be redone with the word nigger removed?
No.
Why?
Because all right, I'm nailed. You got me.
Okay, thank you, Kyle. Right. Seriously, that takes balls to admit you're wrong.
Yeah, no one does that.
I'm done with
you're
that.
Right.
All right.
Oh, you know what?
Thank you, Kyle.
So go home and get your fucking shine box.
Thank you. That's wonderful.
Yes. Right.
Hey, Lou. You think
Frank Vincent quotes?
Listen, he said it. We didn't say it.
Just a question, because it goes back to the 9/11 stuff and all. You think slavery was bad for everybody that was a slave?
That was a slave?
That was a slave.
Do you think like one guy was kind of cool?
I'm just asking the question. Think there were some slaves that went, holy fuck, this is a pretty good damn life I got.
No, because you can't choose it. You can't make a choice. That's essential to his human happiness.
Some guys had better experiences. The ones that worked in the house. That's where that
some people found happiness inside of lives.
Was everybody happy that slavery was abolished?
You would still be the burden.
Or did some people go, fuck, I had it actually pretty easy doing what I was doing. And now
when I learned American history, back when I was in junior high school, because that's as far as my education really got. I was in high school, but I didn't learn anything there. Life got very suddenly difficult for people after they were freed. Their lives were simpler, and then some of them, their lives got more difficult. But I think if you had asked them, they would have said life is hard now, but I'd rather that than be a slave. I would say most people.
You always going to have some that'll like take
yeah,
that
they're
going to
go,
like,
you
really?
Know, that, certainly, yeah, life was easier than.
It's like
I can
prison.
Think that
there
about a
people,
lot of times in my life that were worse, but easier.
There are people in prison that don't want to ever get out of prison. So
yeah. Also, by the way, those people, the slaves that were freed, took a hit for the rest of for every generation after them. They had the hardest job, which was to transition to a free life, and they suffered for it because nobody, because suddenly they go from being slaves, somebody who at least the whites would protect them just because they're their property, just based on you know with the same protection of like stay off my lawn, stop hitting my slave, and then suddenly they become just their neighbor who they hate.
Right,
and who
right.
they'll do any, who they just, because they're so bored of being poor that they just take it out on black people. So yeah, I think that it was probably black people that were bitter. I'm talking totally out of my ass. It's not my experience, but I'm
speculating.
If I was to speculate, I would say there are people
awful,
like this. Fucking, I think I wouldn't be left with like I shouldn't have been freed. I would have been left with white people really stink because first they fucking capture you, own you, and then they let you go and beat the shit out of you till you die. I really am not fond of whites. That would have been my prevailing feeling for anybody at that time.
Are you sure?
Not freedom stinks, but white people aren't fun in any capacity.
They're not being fun and nice.
No, they're not being fun and nice.
I think if slaves were kind of given some
of the shit, I love.
Sorry.
No, no, no.
That guy's not really nice. It's like this, there's a Gary Larson cartoon of hell, and there's two guys sitting in the corner of hell waiting to get, like, tortured, and one guy's whispering to the other guy, I hate this place. It's like sort of off. It's not for me. I'm not into this. So I suppose there's black people that were like that.
Yeah, I think it's put a terrible burden on the country in many, many ways over many, many years.
You know, like Kyle's call, though, is he's a black guy. He's fucking doesn't like the word nigger. Fair enough. But it's like that reaction, that initial just that anger about it. It's like when you break it down logically, it's like it shouldn't be taken out.
Yeah.
To be pleasant or to be polite, you can't change something that makes you realize how horrible
something was.
You should read that and feel unpleasant about it.
Yeah, that's what Mark Twain was
also
going for.
It's what he wrote. It's what Mark Twain wrote.
Yeah, yeah.
Leave
regardless,
his shit alone.
It's what he wrote.
It's what he wrote. It's a insight into his mind and even if he wrote it for a nefarious reason, it's what he wrote. Either don't print the book or print it.
Or don't buy it for schools if you don't think kids are reading.
Go have him read another book.
What are they going to read? A Harry Potter book. Birth of a Nation.
Yeah, no, it makes no sense.
Let's read.
It's funny though. True, people are so excited to get offended and to clack it on the keyboard or make that phone call that they don't think about it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't think about it. And you give him one simple argument. What, should you take it out of roots? No, but... Oh, yeah, that's right.
Like, why? Why should you?
Oh, yeah.
That's why my nickname is... Oh, sorry.
Oh, what?
I was going to say my nickname is the Slippery Slope Kid. I really know how to bring up slippery slopes.
And that's why you got to fight it, because then you start here, they just continue. And they edit everything. Every movie we know, every book we know.
You can't
history
edit...
History in general, they would love to edit.
You can't edit unpleasant things.
Right.
They're there. History. Don't watch them or don't read them. I mean, it's why I wear a shirt that says, hey, the knob has an on and off switch.
This guy, you gotta love that.
This guy's got some insight on the guy that's doing this. Daniel in Oklahoma, you know a little more than we do, hopefully.
Yeah, I read
Welcome
an
aboard, Dan.
Thanks, Jim. I read an interview with the guy,
no, you didn't.
And it's just one guy. This was not like a publisher's decision. It wasn't like a board of people who decided to do this. It was one guy, he's a Mark Twain scholar, I guess, as much as you could be.
Right.
And then he goes around and he, like, does presentations at schools about the books and stuff. And he found that a lot of teachers are afraid to assign the book as reading because of that word. So what he did, he rewrote the book, because it's like, what, a public domain, somebody can publish it. And at the beginning of the book, there's a several-page foreword that explains that this has been censored. And it basically says, anytime nigger, I'm going to put slave. Like, you basically know that up front.
But
he just did it so that teachers can assign the book and kids can learn it and want it. And
it's a fucking shame. It's a fucking shame because kids should know.
You know, it's not a conspiracy, and it's not. He doesn't feel guilty about it.
I believe it is. No, it isn't a conspiracy. It's just a bad decision, and it's
of course it is,
and it has an impact because kids that are going to read the book aren't going to know what history was like. They're not going to know how bad things were. They're also not going to know. Well, how the story works. They're not going to understand the irony, almost the dichotomy, or other words I don't know exactly what they mean, of this of this kid having a friend who he calls Nigger Jim, and he has affection for him, and actually is thinking about turning him in. He's actually thinking, well, if I was taught the golden rule, turn niggers in when they run away. Like that's what it was to grow up in that time.
Yeah.
Come on, Nigger Jim, you're my pal. What a crazy sentence that is. Leave it the fuck alone.
Yeah.
Let kids deal with that. Not only the reality of how hard things were for black people, but that there were friendships that included moments like saying, Nigger Jim, you're my best friend, or whatever. I don't know the book well enough to come up with, but there's probably some, like there was a movie about Hitler that came out a few years ago with John Cusack, where he knows he's a friend of young Hitler when he was an artist. And he says to him,
"Fun Hitler."
And he says to him at one point, "Oh, Hitler, let me buy you a lemonade." That's a quote from the movie. Hitler, let me buy you a lemonade. What a crazy thing! But it's a valuable thing for people to know that Hitler was once some art student that somebody took sympathy on and bought him a lemonade to cheer him up.
Who knew he liked
lemonade? Did he drink it? Did he accept the lemonade?
He accepted the lemonade and said,
I'm going to kill every Jew. Yeah.
Did he see the lemonade and go, wow, this would make great dye for numbers? Really started the ball rolling.
See, because they were yellow. Probably good thing you didn't ask for orange juice.
I didn't hear you, sir. We talked over you. I apologize.
I was trying to do a chip. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
You're gone. Thank you.
I actually didn't hear that one.
Yeah.
Louis, you like that your kids go to public schools?
Yeah, I do. I think public school is an important part of how things work.
Are they learning when they work. Proper things, you think?
No, but they got, you know, it's good they're getting a bad education to get. No, we have a particularly good public school in our neighborhood because we have wealthier people in our neighborhood.
But you seeing that PC shit, though?
Fact. What's that?
The PC shit?
No,
it's Merry Christmas at that school? Still?
I can't remember if in Christmas we had Christmas stuff up. I don't know. I don't care about that. I don't believe that that's the fucking battleground.
the happy holidays.
Bill
O'Reilly.
Who gives a shit? There's no. Oh, yeah, well, you're defending Santa Claus and
you're
Jesus.
You're a pinhead then.
Yeah, apparently I'm a pinhead.
Pinhead and not on his face.
I don't think it makes any difference. Is that cheesy? When they say Merry Christmas in school, it's just as cheesy as when they say Happy Holidays to everyone. Sure. I don't care.
Okay.
But the kids' education is, I think it's really a huge part of why America grew well, even though it's now dying poorly.
A horrible death.
That people would all throw into this one school, and wherever you live, that's where you went, you know, and that it was paid for by a collective, and kids in your neighborhood and teachers in your neighborhood all interacted. Rather than this idea that a school is being paid for and selecting children, you get all these things like fake diversity in private schools, where private schools brag that they have a certain amount of, you know, just enough black people.
Just enough diversity.
Yeah, to not
to say
bother
we're diverse.
You.
To make everyone comfortable.
Yeah. But public schools are just very ad hoc. They're very imperfect and they're good.
What's ad hoc mean?
Ad hoc means kind of put together without a plan, I think.
Yeah, it's like an ad hoc.
Sounds
committee.
Right.
Yeah, there's layers of lumpy paint. There's not really a, you know,
and you
can't
get the shit beat out of you by the diverse crowd in public school.
Yeah. Yeah, and you just do your best in a public school, and it's got the depth that you can go in. You know, if you're a kid that's really curious, you can learn. Otherwise, you might be ignored. It's sort of up to you.
Learn more about, like, real life and how to function in a society.
But it's terrible that there are places where there is no good public school. I mean, there's neighborhoods in America where there is no accredited school, where there is no school.
Yeah.
There's a lot, like in Lowell, Mass. I think my friend of mine is a doctor, and he bought a mansion in Lawrence, Massachusetts, because it cost him $15. And he started living there and opened a clinic, and then he learned that there was no school. Literally, the public schools were so bad that they lost accreditation. That if you graduated from the local school, you couldn't go to college.
It didn't matter. You just went and
no, it totally, because they didn't have enough money to keep the schools going. There was no private school, so literally those kids were just that weren't growing up illiterate.
Wow,
that's fucked up, and it should be, I think, fixed through public school. I don't believe in all this charter shit and private school vouchers. I don't personally believe it. That's just my belief, though.
I went to a great tax. I know that, and I don't have no kids.
What's that?
I ain't got no kids, but I pay a lot of school tax.
Yes, you do.
Yeah.
So enjoy your education, kids.
I guess it's so they're not throwing shit at my house.
That's all it is.
Yeah.
It's keeping the dirty folks in this building.
The nice schools, because if you have nice schools, then it keeps nice people in your neighborhood.
That's right.
So it's pretty much I'm paying extortion money to
keep the neighborhood
the bad people out of my neighborhood.
They get you coming and going, Ant, right? How many times have we said that?
Right in the pocketbook. They get you right in the pocketbook, Jim.
Running out of show. One more phone call for Louis C.K. because it's a good one. Melissa, what do you got for Louis?
Oh, you saved the best for last. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Hi, Melissa.
What are you laughing at?
I have been married for 10 years, and just recently I started really changing my viewpoint on that, and listening to the show has been a big help, and you in particular have really led me in the right direction, so I just wanted to thank you.
So do what? Divorce?
You got out of a bad marriage?
She's trying not to say what she's...
Yeah.
You got, okay, good.
Because of Louis C.K.?
Pretty much, more or less, yeah.
There you go, Lo. You're helping people.
Well, what was wrong with the marriage that you had to get out of it?
It just wasn't working. Yeah. I don't want to get too specific.
Oh, no, vague. Keep it vague.
Do you have kids?
That's what I do. But yeah, it's
you have kids?
It's been no, and that that's
oh, so, you know, fucking cares
what helped. Yeah. Exactly.
He wanted
well,
an ass.
Did he ever hit you?
Some ass.
Did he ever hit you?
Was it physically abusive?
No.
What do you do wrong?
What are you, the Kramer versus Kramer lawyer? Did he hit you at all? Was he an alcoholic? Yeah. Did he blow his money? Did he? Well, then I can see why you left him. Next witness.
I don't want to put blame on
you. Want the kid, don't you?
What makes a woman cheating. A better parent simply by virtue of her sex? That's a great line from Kramer.
Infidelity.
By virtue of her sex.
I don't know who that was. Infidelity.
Jerry Seinfeld.
That was good.
No, yeah, marriages are sometimes they just stink. Every fucking day stinks. And then you stop talking about it because it's so bad that you can't communicate because the only communication would be, honey, I'm not feeling so good about us. I know because every day sucks and we should split up. That's a hard thing to say out loud. But there's nothing, you know, it's natural. Why should nothing is going to just keep going except for Opie's marriage. Other than that,
it really is a happy marriage.
I really think marriages should be finite. I really think you should sign like a 5-year, 10-year contract.
Oh yeah.
Depending on your
re-up.
You should be on the re-up after that. Yeah. Getting married.
Well, that's like if you were to like do a 10-year, 5-year. Yeah. I love you. I want to marry you for 10 years. Yeah. And then around 9 years, you start talking about, do you want to keep doing this?
Renegotiate.
You want to keep re-up? Well, then you could say, here's why I'm not crazy about re-upping. You could actually say it.
Yeah,
if you're 9
yeah.
years deep into a forever relationship, you can't even talk about the problems because there's so much at stake. But if you were at year 9, you'd be like, okay, here's what I hate about you. If you could change 40% of these, I would hang in for another 5 years.
And then
the other person goes, I don't want to change this. I don't want to change this.
What a brilliant idea.
Well, because we're talking about changing marriage to be civil unions anyway, to be a civil union, by the way, is a prenuptial agreement. That's what it is.
Yeah.
A prenuptial agreement is a civil union. It's a court-based
civil. And thank God for those.
Civil. So you write those out.
No wonder he left.
And then every marriage will become. Wow. I know. Every marriage will become.
Exactly. The men are talking.
Yeah, why don't you go grab some coffee for the boys?
Go ahead and make some cookies. I want to smell cookie dough wafting out of the kitchen.
Yeah,
you
me
waddle
too.
Around in your apron while the men talk. And fucking drag your cunt into the fucking kitchen.
Yeah. Make no, listen, cookies. I'm glad you got out of there. It's not.
I'm only kidding, madam.
There's a lot of pressure on married people to stay together. By people that have no stake in it.
Yes.
No, you got to hang in there. You don't live in my fucking house, you know? So
you don't know the misery.
No, and if you don't have kids, I don't even care. I mean, if you don't have kids, you broke up with your boyfriend.
You're dating, right?
Yeah, who gives a fuck? It's meaningless.
It does become different when you become a father. Holy
yeah, that's
shit,
it.
Man.
Totally different.
Well, in
world.
Any event, thank you, Louis.
All right, Melissa. Sure.
Go bye, Melissa. Yeah.
Good luck to you.
With that, we got to thank Louis C.K. It was great catching up with Louis, man.
Always.
Thank you, fellas.
He's really famous.
Yes, he is.
Oh,
very famous now.
Oh, my God. No, it's. I'm at the White House.
I'll tell you what.
That's what, you know what, when I tweeted the Sarah Palin cunt tweets, the thought I had up there in the sky was, I've put a glass ceiling on my career. I just put a glass ceiling.
You'll never be the guy at the White House.
I will never be at the White House correspondence. No. Like, that's like the heavyweight champion of the world. That's what every great comic gets to eventually, is roasting the president.
Yeah.
And in the White House, and somebody will vet me for that at some point, just because I'm one of the, you know, I'm on a list, a short list of comedians in the world. I don't know how short the list is, at least 20 or so, and if you who are alive and working, and if you tick down that list, you get to my name. Click Google. Nah, let's not invite that problem.
Comments. That's gonna be a problem.
Sarah Palin's retard making cunt. I don't think we want.
That's gonna be a problem.
Steer clear of this one.
To give the, you know, Chris or whatever the fucking people at Fox News are.
Yeah, we don't want to.
All right.
Barack Obama apparently thought it would be funny to have this guy who said
Beck.
Sarah Palin's son was a retard.
Now, if a Republican comic had said something like that, they'd have hung him out to dry.
They really would have done a number on that one.
I do love the hypocrisy there.
Fucking Louis, you rule. All right, what do we got to do? We got to make sure people see Hilarious. It's going to be on Comedy Central Sunday night at 10 p.m., and then the DVD/CD will be available Tuesday for Hilarious.
Yes, and Louis will come back on FX in June.
Can't fucking wait, Louis.
New episodes.
We can't wait for that. And Jimmy, you good?
All I got is Cap City in Austin, I've never done Austin, Texas. I'm doing that for the first time in a few weeks.
Great club.
And the late show at the Borgata, we have a few tickets available for the 15th late show, and that's it.
Okay. And
Paul's good.
We're going to go to break with another taste of hilarious for the